inside that we need so much. The sight of a touch or the scent of a sound or the strength of an oak with roots deep in the ground. The wonder of flowers to be covered and then to burst up through tarmac to the sun again. Or to fly to the sun without burning a wing. To lie in a meadow and hear the grass sing. To have all these things in our memories hoard and they use them.
From the high desert and the great American Southwest, exclusively on Sirius XM Radio, this is Dark Matter with your host, Art Bell. Now, here's Art.
Well, hello, and welcome to Extraterrestrial Radio. It's called Dark Matter, and I am Art Bell. It's great to be here. Really great to be here tonight. I've got a few housekeeping issues to begin with tonight. I said last night, this is Sirius XM Radio, right? No rules. Well, one rule. My rule. No bad language. And then I went back to the house, you know, after the show, and I downloaded all my email, and I had like 600 emails saying, oh, Art, they played this and they played that in the middle of commercial and commercials and stuff. And Sirius XM violated the Prime directive, but it's fixed. So it's fixed. They promised me tonight all the things that'll fill the breaks will be clean and available for listening for delicate ears, including mine. So no bad language here. It's a bad language free zone. Okay. And then there was WRT 104. The big gamma burst. God, I've got to tell you all, you know, I've done a lot of shows and it always happens to me that a guest will drop something on me that you go, say what? a gamma ray burst and we're in the gun barrel. I think I'm quoting fairly accurately here, right? We're in the gun barrel. So, you know, I did as Professor Kaku suggested, and I looked up WRT 104. And I'm on channel 104, right? See, that bothered me right away. They don't really number, if you ever go on your phone or tablet or something, they actually don't number the channels. That's something I want to talk to Sirius XM about. You know, they say we're on 104, the indie channel. I know that's where we are. But when you look on the menu, there's no number. At least I can't find it. So WRT 104, great. Gamma ray burst, great. Sterilizing the planet kind of gamma ray burst, great. So here's what I want you to do. I did do the research, and I sent Keith Roland, my webmaster, a picture of WR104. He's got it up on artbell.com. So you can actually see a picture of these two suns getting ready to dance. Oh, geez. And then there's also a moving file which will show you what a gamma ray burst will look like. Now, I don't know what it's going to look like from the perspective of the end of the gun barrel, but maybe we're going to find out. Anyway, I thought you'd want to know what it looks like, those two stars coming together. They've got an actual picture up there. The other is a simulation of a gamma ray burst. None of it's good. Not good at all. We've got an interesting program coming up tonight, Dr. Stephen Greer. He's an old friend, great guy, and we're going to squeeze a lot from him tonight. All right, very quickly, around the... Oh, the naval yard shooting. Well, the press is always, you know, I'm sure Pierce Morgan is at it tonight. The guns have to go. You know, as I've been watching all of this develop on the across the media, it occurs to me that, yeah, something's got to go, but it's not the guns. It's people who hear voices. Now, if we could control those people, we'd have hold of the problem. It's crazy people. Even Dr. Kutku last night said it's crazy people, right? They hear voices.
Give these papers to the Russians. Kill a bunch of people.
Whatever. You know, this guy had a secret clearance with the Navy. A secret clearance. So I heard he went in twice, you know, complaining that he was hearing voices, right? Oh, come on. If, you know, if that's the case, then get some counseling. And, you know, upon getting the counseling, at the very least, somebody ought to say something. I mean, if you've got a secret clearance, so, you know, instead of controlling guns, control people who hear voices. They should be taken care of and helped. That's all I've got to say about that. Briefly looking around the world, it's a kind of an open and shut case. Word of the opening of Iran's blocked social media sites. They blocked everything. Iran just blocked everything. And then opened it up, and everybody went, yay, and now they blocked it again. It's like an open and shut case. Brazil plans to divorce itself from the U.S.-centric internet over Washington's widespread online spying. A move that sends chills down the experts. You know, the dangerous potential first step toward fracturing a global network built with minimal interference by governments. Well, anybody been up to Utah lately? I don't know about minimal. The Concordia is coming back up. She went down, and it was very embarrassing for the government in Italy, and now she has been righted. And the government in Italy feels better. Russia said Tuesday the UN Security Council resolution governing Syria's handling of its chemical weapons not allow the use of force. Well, if we can't use force, if they don't comply, then why should they comply? You know, it seems like a fairly logical train of thought, doesn't it? A typhoon hit Japan Monday. Now, it's not good. The Japanese had to dump a whole lot more water, radioactive water, albeit, into the ocean. We don't know how much yet, but it was bad, bad, bad news for the Japanese. And probably bad news for us, too, huh? And I swear I'm going to do a whole show on this. The Russians, Putin came after us for American exceptionalism, right? Oh, God, what a phrase, American exceptionalism. And now Putin is, I guess, blaming American exceptionalism for the shooting. Me, I think it was a guy who hears voices. All right, that's it for now. We're going to take a very quick break, and then we'll come back. And we'll meet with Dr. Stephen Greer. It's going to be quite a program. I think you're going to enjoy it. From the high desert and the great American Southwest, this is Dark Matter. You're welcome back.
Thank you. Yeah.
You really can. You can go almost without taking a breath. I've been sitting here amazed at that.
Oh, well, I'm just sharing the sort of like the tips of the iceberg that I know. You know.
Yeah. When you get going. In terms of, our government has told us, you know, way back after Roswell, that among other things, UFOs are no threat militarily to the United States. Now, that's, they've said that, and of course that they're just not real. There is no documented cases, and that's bull. We just finished talking about a U.S. astronaut who watched one land, took photographs of it that went into a black hole somewhere, and there's a lot more stories, and these stories are real, aren't they? In other words...
Oh, sure. They're backed up with documents and with radar traces and everything else. So, you know, it's like, you know, I often get asked, you know, hey, you know, where's the beef? Where's the evidence? I said, well, right. It's there. The fact that you haven't seen it those are two separate issues. And by the way, you know, a lot of the people that I've met with in the government who are pranced out to tell people, oh, well, you know, this isn't true and we know nothing of this. They're actually telling the truth from their perspective. In other words,
sure.
They honestly don't know anything about it. And when they make an inquiry through this massive, huge, complex system that's built up since World War II, they can't penetrate into the secrecy. And so when they report out to the public, I mean, this is where you get into this whole concept of plausible deniability. They would pass a lie detector test and they're not lying. So now, are there some devils out there who do know who've lied in the past? Yes. But for the most part, the people who go out there and say this, who are usually fairly low-level people or people who wouldn't have a need to know, are speaking the truth to the extent they know it.
Okay. What is your view? Our military has said they're not a threat to us. Are they or are they not, Doctor?
Oh, I think not. I mean, one of the things that I went and did back some years ago, I went to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, where a lot of the remains of some of these objects that we had targeted with electromagnetic weapons that had been downed were sent back in the early days. Now, we're talking the post-World War II period and onward. It's not really that key of facility anymore, but Wright-Patterson was way back in those days. And I was asked to have a meeting there with the head of the Foreign Aerospace Science and Technology Center, which had been the Foreign Technology Division of the Air Force. And in fact, the man who ordered it was the head of intelligence for the Joint Staff. And I went there, and one of the things that the colonel in charge, Colonel Canola, asked me, he said, you know, well, in your study of this, you think that they could be a threat to our national security. I said, you're asking the wrong question. Could they be? Yes. If you have interstellar travel capability, you're kind of beyond rockets and jets, all right? But are they? The answer is no, because I said, given the galactically stupid things we have done, where we have pursued them and fired on these objects, et cetera, and so forth, if they were hostile, it would have been point, set, match, over. Back about 1945. In other words, about the time we detonated the first atomic weapon at the Trinity site, if this had been the intent of these visitors, it would have been made crystal clear to us. So I'm very skeptical of all the sci-fi and, you know, they're coming to eat us for lunch routine that you hear from folks. But
okay, but there was there not, an instance in which UFOs hovered above a ICBM facility.
Oh, yeah.
And actually began started a countdown here in the U.S. and then I believe shut one down in the USSR at that time. And if that's not a threat.
Well, no, actually what happened is that they took 16, at least 16 intercontinental ballistic missiles at Minot, North Dakota, offline. And rendered them non-launchable. Now, the same thing was happening in the old Soviet Union.
Yes.
And the men, we have several of these men who were at the facility in Minot, North Dakota, when this happened.
Do you know where I heard that, Doctor? It was on years ago, 2020.
Yes, and actually I met with Sam Donaldson and talked to him about this at ABC News about what they had looked into over in the Soviet Union. And what we, by piecing these cases together, and also with Colonel Diedrichsen. Colonel Diedrichsen, if you go to our website, seriousdisclosure.com, he's one of our witnesses who was over the old Atomic Energy Commission, that's now the Department of Energy. But his responsibility were all nuclear processing facilities, weapon storage areas in the United States arsenal. And that was his position. And what he and other people I've talked to have said to me is that there was a clear interest by these visitors in these weapons, but not in a hostile way, but a concern that we might end up destroying this whole planet, which for all we know, they may have a long-term interest in that goes back for thousands, perhaps millions of years, and that's another discussion. But obviously, what they were trying to say, and in fact, one of the Captain Sala, who was there at the mine of North Dakota, when I talked to him about this, he said his feeling about this, as this was unfolding with this luminous object outside the silo and with these 16 thermonuclear weapons with multiple warheads, by the way, going offline and being rendered unlaunchable, is that the message he felt they were sending was, if you fools go to mutual assured destruction, we can do something about that, but for God's sakes, don't. In other words, okay. It was sort of a cautionary thing, because I mean, let's take two steps, big long steps back.
Well, maybe that was a message, but listen, the military usually doesn't get subtle messages. I mean, when you shut down their ICBMs, they think big time threat.
Well, they see certainly the capability to render all those little toys pretty useless, and I think,
well, yeah, that's a threat.
From my perspective, good. But from the perspective of someone whose responsibility it is to keep us in a state of readiness to launch those objects, if we had a full thermonuclear exchange during the Cold War, it would have been the end of life on Earth, and everybody knows that with nuclear winter and what have you. But mm-hmm. I think that. The bigger question is, if those events are true, and they are, and here's the case, and in fact we have the documents, we have multiple independent corroborating witnesses to this case that you've just asked about in the Disclosure Project materials, what was the point? Well, I think the point was, when you piece it together with what was going on in the old Soviet Union, a very similar events, is that they were trying to get us to rethink that whole strategy of mutual assured destruction.
What happened in the Soviet Union?
Well, there were multiple events where silos and thermonuclear missiles, intercontinental missiles, were rendered not only unlaunchable, but were actually, in a couple cases where they were testing them, at least the missile part of it, were made to go completely haywire. In fact, there's a case where this was happening, as you know, from Vandenberg Air Force Base. The same thing happened with one of our witnesses for the Disclosure Project, testified that he was there doing all the very high-tech imagery of this launch. And so this is what happened in the Soviet Union. They launched one of these, didn't have an active hot, obviously a nuclear warhead on it, mm-hmm. but they were trying, and they would be intercepted, and basically as they became exo-atmospheric, in other words, just as they're leaving the atmosphere and going to go intercontinental, they're pretty much just taken out, neutralized. And he actually saw this happen, this particular witness, from a Vandenberg Air Force Base launch, and after he and Major Flores started talking about this, he was threatened. He had his mailbox blown up. He had all kinds of weird stuff start happening, and weird calls in the middle of the night, cursing at him and what have you. But he stayed, and he's a professor, Jacobs, and he has come forward, and we have his testimony now about that whole event. Well, similar things were happening in the old Soviet Union, and by the way, also with some of the French and British facilities. One of the most compelling and interesting cases that, of course, I spoke at great length with the former head of the Ministry of Defense for Great Britain, Lord Hill Norton, who I spent some time at his home in Hampshire discussing all this. And back in the 80, about 1980, 81, I believe it was, we had at the Randlesham Forest, the Bentwaters case, they call it, the Bentwaters,
yes.
The Royal Air Force Base. It was actually more of a U.S. Air Force Base. It was both British and U.S., but it was a covert nuclear weapons facility that was not acknowledged to the Soviet Union and would have caused a huge amount of political problems in Great Britain. And with our talks with the Soviet Union, had it been acknowledged, but there were hot thermonuclear weapons there, and it was a ready base, even though it wasn't acknowledged to the public. And for several nights, there were these UFOs seen in the skies near this Air Force base. And then on this one particular night, there was an object that came down and landed out on the edge of the base. And of course, it later they tried to debunk it that they just saw a distant lighthouse, and they make up all kinds of absurd stories. But the men who actually were sent out there to see this particular object, it turns out it was a black pyramid-shaped ET craft that, as it landed, it came down and it actually scraped some trees and broke some branches and then left a perfectly square base landing area with various changes, radiological changes in the soil that has now been confirmed by the Ministry of Defense of Great Britain. Now, this was denied and lied about for years in the United Kingdom. And interestingly, Lord Hill Norton, who was a five-star admiral back then, they had what they call Sea Lords, and he was the five-star admiral. He was the head of the military committee for NATO, but he was also the Minister of Defense. And in Great Britain, for those who don't know, that also means you're head of MI5 and MI6. It's like our CIA director, all in one position. So I'm sitting here talking to this gentleman, and he's telling me that the entire time he was Minister of Defense, and on the head of the military committee for NATO, he had no knowledge of this subject. It was only afterwards that he began to find out about it. And he was furious, frankly. You know, I'm sitting at this man's house. He's this old, you know, admiral. And he is, like, hopping mad. I mean, pissed off that here he was sitting on top of the entire defense establishment in Great Britain. There were these sort of events going on kind of under his nose. He had no knowledge of it. And he admitted that to me. And
all right. So, I mean, what you're telling me and have told me again and again in this these first segments is that there is a government and then there is a group of people who have this information, control this information, and control those who would like to know this information, apparently, in government. In other words, we have a government within or beyond a government. Correct.
Right, and this is precisely what Eisenhower was warning about. When Eisenhower said, beware the military-industrial complex. I mean, he was a five-star general, World War II hero. He was not anti-military. He was opposed to this out-of-control aspect of it that and I'm not criticizing Eisenhower, but this whole mess got out of control on his watch between 1953 and 1961. That's when.
All right, Doctor, why not disclosure? In other words, with the shape the world's in right now, not that hot, frankly.
Right.
It seems to me that disclosure, if done correctly,
right,
would just lift all boats.
Well,
and,
not all boats. Now let me stop you right
most
there.
Most right? Boats. How about that?
Yeah, 99.99999% of humanity's boats would be lifted. The 0.00000, forget the 1%. We're talking about the uber elite. And actually, at this meeting I was attending a couple weeks ago with all these leaders from around the world, and you had people there from Goldman Sachs and McKinsey and Boston Consulting Group and all kinds of folks. And what the discussion, the title of the entire conference weekend was, From Disruption, Opportunity. And I was there to present the case for disrupting the current status quo of terminating the oil, gas, and coal industries over the next 10 to 20 years and bringing these sciences out that would explain how UFOs are moving. Now, the reason for the secrecy in the early days, I mean, let's go to ancient times, 40s, 50s, 60s. A, they didn't know what they were dealing with. B, they were trying to figure out how these objects moved. going, for example, the head of the Belgian Air Force, General de Brouwer, when we went to Belgium, and, you know, here he's talking about the fact that in Belgium they had these massive triangular ships that were about 800 feet on each side that were going from completely still and hovering to several thousand miles per hour straight up against gravity and making right-hand turns outside the envelope of any normal aerodynamics of a jet or a rocket or anything else. And I have a quote, actually, on our website from him talking about this, and we actually have a radar tape of that event from Belgium. So what's interesting is that, obviously, these objects aren't using Exxon Jet A fuel. They're not using oil. They're not using normal rockets and things of this sort. And so the technology and the physics, and this is the part of this that I actually was the hardest part to kind of get through the head of the policy people at this meeting, is that the secrecy has nothing to do with ETs, and it has nothing to do with the fact that people are going to hurl themselves off the Brooklyn Bridge if there's intelligent life out there. I mean, more than half the public believes there's life out there already. What
you're going to tell me, it's energy.
It's about money and power and energy. So, you know, let's cut to the chase here. These UFOs are not operating using the internal combustion engine that Mercedes invented in 1888 or
no,
what have you. All right?
Sure,
so,
not, right.
So this is not your granddad's Oldsmobile.
Okay. So, all right. So there are. There are many different types of propulsion that we can imagine. Here's my next question. Are we actually, Doctor, aware of the operational details of propulsion systems that could be applied to U.S. and world energy needs?
Yes, and you know what's interesting, in a document that was released accidentally in Canada that dates from 1951, now this is before I was a twinkle in my father's eye, by a man named Wilbur Smith, and it's a top secret document. He was head of Project Magnet that was studying this issue in Canada. And I'm quoting here, where he says, the matter is the most highly classified subject in the United States government, rating higher even than the H-bomb. Flying saucers exist. Period. Their modus operandi, meaning their propulsion system, is unknown, but a concentrated effort is being made by a small group headed by Dr. Vannevar Bush. The entire matter is considered by the United States authorities to be of tremendous significance. Now, this is an uncontested top secret document. Who was Vannevar Bush? He was the guy who headed up the Manhattan Project, the mastermind behind it, much more so than Teller and Oppenheimer. So, what began in the 40s and 50s, and particularly after World War II, was...
It's always a Bush.
They're not related, but was a very serious, a very, very serious look at how are these objects getting their energy supply, and how are they moving in these non-aerodynamic ways. Now, by October, a man who I've worked with for many years, the senior scientist at the Naval Research Labs, Rick Foch, the third-ranking highest guy at the Naval Research Labs, was in, quote, the vault that has a lot of the documents on this issue. And he was able to confirm to us that in October of 1954, around that date, again before I was a twinkle in my father's eye, we mastered, quote, gravity control. In other words, the energy and propulsion aspects of these objects were definitively known by October 1954. So for the last 50-some years, our burning oil and gas and coal and using jet engines and all that jazz has just really been an artifice, because it's a multi-trillion, in fact, a multi-hundred trillion dollar asset-based question of what do you do? And yes, most people would benefit from this information, and anyone interested in the future of the Earth and in sustainability and the environment and world poverty and 7 billion people in China and in India, 2.5 billion in China and India, trying to live like you and I do, burning coal for our electricity, anyone with an IQ greater than mud is going to go, how are we going to keep doing this? We can't. Now, however, if you're one of the masters of the universe at Goldman Sachs or in these big trading houses with all their enormous wealth that they're trading on the petrodollar system and all these commodities, quote unquote, such as oil and gas and coal and natural gas and centralized utilities and on and on and on. This is not a few billion or a few hundred billion. This is trillions and trillions of dollars in assets that are in, hanging in the balance. And so it's really the tail is wagging the dog here. And so the secrecy has much more to do with geopolitical power and keeping kind of the status quo as it is. Now, at a certain way back, you could kind of almost understand it because people didn't understand that we were going to go from having 3 or 4 billion people to 7 billion people, on and on and on. But now in 2013, I think the secrecy has become an existential threat to our civilization. And this is what the first CIA director was saying when he said that the threat isn't from the UFOs, it's from the secrecy around the subject. And that's what he says.
My IQ is only hovering above mud, but it's there. So I want to ask you, do you have the details on these energy systems? Do you know the answer to this? Do you know what kind of energy we can suddenly begin using, Doctor, that we're not using, that's been held secret? Or do you know who knows?
The answer to both, yes. But, you know, I'm just a country doctor here in Virginia, and I'm not an engineer. But I do I understand it, and have I seen how these objects work? Yes. In fact, I was in a facility near the Huntsville Space Flight Center in the Redstone Arsenal a few years ago, where I was taken into a place where there were these objects that were hovering and floating around using this type of high voltage system, and it was an ion propulsion. And later, this same system was reproduced at the hangar at the Naval Research Labs there in near Washington, not far from where this shooting just happened yesterday. And the people who were part of that project have spent time at my home, and what they've discussed is that if you take a very high voltage signal system and you put it at a certain resonant frequency, a certain cycles per second, all right? We're not talking about 110 voltage or 220 out of your home outlet, but millions of volts, but at very low current. So you're not using much power. Okay. You can create what's called a Poynting vector. I don't want to get too much into the physics because people fall asleep. But you can create a vector into what's called the zero-point energy field. And you can pull energy out of this so-called zero-point energy field or quantum vacuum that is huge amount of energy. I mean, it's estimated that every cubic centimeter of space in your room where you're sitting would run the United States for a day just because there's so much potential power there. Now, has this been proven and published in physics journals? Yes. Look up the Casimir effect. The Casimir effect decades ago was proven, and it's been reproduced, that this zero-point energy field exists. The question is, have there been any breakthroughs in the application of this theoretical physics?
All right, Doctor, yes. Hold your head. We've got to do a break, so relax, take a good deep breath, and we'll be right back.
Sure.
You're listening to Dr. Stephen Greer, CSETI's Dr. Stephen Greer, and of course, Dark Matter. I'm Art Bell. Welcome back, Dr. Stephen Greer. I want to describe something to you, Doctor, and it's the truth. And you tell me what I've got. I've got an antenna here that I've had for years and years, and it's got a kind of a bunch of interesting stuff about it. For example, it covers 5 acres. It's called a double loop antenna, and it covers 5 acres. The high point is about 100 feet. The lowest it gets is about 76 feet. Now, here's what's special about this antenna. Number one, it creates its own voltage. It creates extremely high voltage.
Right.
And even nice, beautiful blue skies, no wind, nothing. It creates enough voltage, Doctor, to knock you right on your butt.
Sure.
And I have no idea where it comes from. Now, it's not a great deal of current, but it is a great deal of voltage and enough current to knock you on your butt. So we're talking about something for years and years and years, I've wondered what it is we're talking about, and I don't know why that voltage is there, but when you close it and put it to ground, you get a nice, long, blue spark. What is all that? Yeah,
well,
what is that?
Part of it is that there's an electromagnetic potential associated with the Earth, that there's a certain degree at the level of the ground, and then there's a certain amount as you go upward, even several meters. In fact, that's why loggers will have to have a ground cable when they're scaling a very, very tall tree in the Pacific Northwest, or they can get shocked. So there is a known voltage delta or differential between the ground and as you go upward into the sky, even a few meters and certainly 100 feet or more. And that is a well-known phenomenon. And can it be harnessed? Yes, it could be. In fact, there are people who discussed how perhaps Nikola Tesla had experimented with some of these unusual antennas and were pulling energy out of this phenomenon. Now, that's, I think, different from what I'm talking about in terms of the quantum vacuum or the so-called zero-point energy field that is the energy.
Can you explain that? What is zero-point energy? What is it?
Okay. That's the energy that's left in any volume of space if you were to cool everything down to absolute zero, minus 273, whatever it is, absolute, where all atomic movement stops, everything stops. There's still an energy potential there, and this has been proven in physics, and as I mentioned, the Casimir effect. What people don't understand, however, is that for over 100 years, scientists such as Faraday, Nikola Tesla, others, in experimenting with high voltage systems, would create a phenomenon where they would tap into that energy that's in the quantum vacuum, and you would end up getting more energy out of, say, a generator than you have to put into it. Now, people say, oh, it's violating the laws of thermodynamics. I said, no, it isn't, because it's pulling energy out that you haven't been calculating is there, but has been proven to be there. So it's energy that's not in outer space. It's in any volume of space, and this is a huge amount of energy, and it's been reported, of course, that Nikola Tesla had an electric car running with an antenna on it, that it recharged itself, and this is true. And in fact, I've got an amazing document. It's on our website where when Nikola Tesla died, the FBI swooped in and confiscated all of his secret papers.
That's right.
And I have a document where the Department of Defense of the United States is demanding that the FBI turn over those files to them, and they wouldn't. And so, you know, you have all these sort of fiefdoms within the government. But
even to this very day, they won't turn it over.
Right. And so what's interesting about this is that the secrecy around the whole UFO and extraterrestrial issue has so much less to do with what most people would imagine than very ordinary things like power and money and oil and gas. And I mean, first of all, let's take a big step back. You know, if you look at the last 150 years since the Industrial Revolution, okay, we had choo-choo trains, which were basically steam engines, and then you had, the early internal combustion cars that Mercedes had, and then, of course,
right.
Ford. So that's over 100 years old. Then you had electricity from burning coal creating a steam turbine or hydroelectric. Jet engines, by the way, were the 30s. And rockets, of course, Wernher von Braun, who's chief spokesperson for the last few years of his life, is one of our Disclosure Project witnesses. Wernher von Braun, who was Adolf Hitler's rocket guy, who was inventing V2 rockets dropping on London, that was the 40s, early 40s. So are we to really believe, and of course the atomic bomb was 1945 at the Trinity site there. Are we really to believe that in 70-some years there have been no breakthroughs in fundamental physics of energy generation and propulsion? Well, that's just nonsense.
You're right. It's very, very hard to believe. There should have been many more breakthroughs in the energy field. And, gee, can we sit here and imagine that, A, there have been, and, B, wonder why they just have sort of not drifted to the top?
Well, here's why. Well, there's a number of reasons why, and I want to get into this just a little bit. On our website, at the Sirius Disclosure, S-I-R-I-U-S Disclosure, all one word, .com, there's a document from the Federation of American Scientists. Now, since I've spoken to you last, Art, this group of very prestigious scientists in Washington, D.C., came out with a, from their national security project, Stephen Aftergood, put out a report. And it was 3 years ago, next month, in October, that this came out. And so it's fairly recent, that there are 5,135 patents that have been seized under the National Security Act. Now, one of the things that they bring up, they don't really drill down on the whole zero-point question and anti-gravity question, but they do mention the fact that 40-some years ago, in 1971, that there was a photovoltaic generator that was more efficient than 20% efficiency, which was unheard of back then, that would have basically competed with the price point for oil and coal. And it was seized under a national security order. Now, what justifiable reason could there be for the abuse of state power to seize someone's invention that was simply a very super efficient solar electric generator in 1971. This is the kind of abuse of power that has gotten us into this kind of mess that no one is talking about. Now, the Federation of American Scientists, which is not some conspiracy group or something, is a very mainstream group, brought this issue up and asked the question in this document, how could this really be justified under the National Security Act, and how many other wonderful technologies have met this demise? So that's one avenue of what I call suppression. The other avenue is, before you even get to filing a patent, you get some goons who knock on your door. And I have a, all right, so I have a man who I had under contract a couple years ago who does a lot of work for the intelligence community and the contracting community, but he had been granted permission to work with us to bring out one of these so-called free energy generators. So, you know, we provided a grant to him so he could do this in his spare time, because he was still working full-time for...
I remember this. I remember.
All right. Now, this man knew how to build something similar to what you're discussing, but much more compact, that you have out at your ranch in Nevada, where it would have basically been something you run your house on this electromagnetic potential. And we wanted to bring this out as sort of a demonstration, proof of principle project. So sure enough, he starts working on this and assembling, and he knows exactly what to do, by the way. This is someone who's not some wild, you know, wild-eyed inventor who knows nothing. This is a very ingenious inventor.
Okay.
And, you know, about the time he gets rolling on this, a former CIA director and a bunch of goons show up at his skiff, his secure facility, and basically threaten him and his wife and tell him to stop working on it, and he does. And we're out the resources and funds we provided, and this guy runs with his tail between his legs.
All right.
So this kind of now this is something that in a court of law I can prove happened.
Okay, and you had money. You had money invested, doctor. You had money invested, right?
Well, invested.
I remember. Well, I remember when you raised that money.
Sure.
I remember. Now, since it got squashed and since he got threatened, I'm sure you have the exact details, don't you, of what was said to him and how it was done?
Oh, sure. And in fact, the people at the Naval Research Labs who brokered the relationship with this gentleman were appalled and shocked at how this was all played out. And
how did it play out? I'm asking you, exactly how did it play out?
Well, after he was really making some progress on a deliverable date, he got a visit from a former CIA director who, ironically, had at one point become the chief counsel for Booz Allen Hamilton, the big contractor that Snowden worked for. And he went down there and basically, with some other folks, threatened this guy. And it said all kinds of things that scared him to the point of stopping doing this. And what I've concluded, here's the problem, the lone wolf approach, you know, and this is all we've had resources to do. We're trying to raise more funds to create a stronger research effort now, is that we would provide, you know, maybe $100,000 to some, a modest grant, so that they could work on something and get something put together. But they're working by themselves, and they're out there as lone wolves who don't have any kind of a tactical security. They don't have any kind of support system, and it's mm-hmm. it's inherently risky. So I'm not going to ever do that again, frankly.
Did they actually threaten his life?
Oh, yes, and his wife. His life and his wife.
God.
Now, it's interesting because the man who first introduced me to him was a very senior scientist at the Naval Research Labs, which is the largest Department of Defense lab in the world, by the way. Thomas Edison founded it. It's interesting history. But he told me that he was involved in an operation where he had learned of some things where he was told point blank that if he were to discuss it publicly, they would kill him, his wife, his children, and his grandchildren. Now, this is not some conspiracy movie. This is someone who has slept at my home, who is a very senior scientist in the government. I mean, it's the highest civilian rank. And this is the kind of thuggish nonsense that does go on. And I think the public needs to know about it, and the public needs to say we're fed up with this foolishness.
Well, of course. I'm curious. Did this impress you to the point that I think you just said it, you would not do it again? In other words, if somebody came to you and said, look, I've really got this, I can demonstrate it for you, I can show you, there's more out than in, it's free energy, whatever you want to call it, I need $100,000 to develop it, what would you say?
I would say no. I would say if, and I could write that check tomorrow, no problem. I would say, if you have something, go and create it and bring it to me, and we will replicate it. But in terms of doing it this other way, we tried that. We actually, you know, I think over the years maybe put $800,000 or $900,000 into those sort of efforts with various folks.
Wow.
Not a lot of money. I mean, as R&D programs go, I mean, hell, you know, my ER had a $20 million budget for, you know, an ER in one town. But I tell people that, you know, this approach is inherently risky, but we did it because that's all the resources we had. Now I've concluded what we really need to do is create a research and development lab where these brilliant geniuses can be brought together and they can be supported and protected and work. And you know what? We'll do something we couldn't have done a few years ago. We'll stream it live on Ustream and dare someone to come in here and threaten these folks. And I think the other mistake that many of these inventors have made is that they've tried to go the intellectual property route with venture capital or through the patent system. Because if you go that route, basically they're going to get it or you're a dead man walking. So I think the only way to do it is that you create it and then you dump it into the internet. You have multiple academic centers, which we've already identified, by the way, reproduce it independently, and you get it out there and you squeeze the toothpaste out of the tube quickly and forcefully. I think any other approach, if you look at the history of this, Dr. Tom Bearden, who's also Lieutenant Colonel in the Army, I was at his home discussing this, and he lives there in Huntsville near the Marshall Space Flight Center, and he and I discussed this for days, and he said basically the mistakes that have been made, there's a set number of them that you can sort of look over the last few decades and see that one inventor after another has made. The big mistake is that people think that they're going to beat someone in the secrecy game. They're not. These guys know everything, everyone. I don't care if you're in the jungle of the Amazon. They're going to know what you're doing and what you got. So you need to be able to have a system, which we have, where you can get it out to the public very quickly. But if you try to sit on it in a secret way and try to make it a intellectual property battle or a patent issue, you're never going to succeed. You're going to lose because you're going to enter into a system that is gamed against you. So I tell people that if they want to do this, they need to learn from history or we're going to be doomed to repeat it. And
from my own part, if somebody set a bullet on the table and said, this bullet has your name on it, you know, I'm being honest here, that would do it. I mean, that would do it. You know, I've got a family. Folks, think of it yourself. If you had this information in your hand and it was going to help the world, it was going to help the country, it's going to help everybody, but they're saying they're going to kill you and they're going to kill your family, what would you do? I think the answer is pretty clear. You'd probably end up buckling.
Well, and that's why you can't do it that way. This is why you have to have a large number of people. You need to have it all being done and watched publicly in real time. And that's what I've concluded over the last decade of looking into this. And I think that that's a very unconventional way. Now, of course, when you go to Silicon Valley and tell a venture capital that, their eyes roll back because they're all about the secrecy of the next iPhone, whatever.
Sure.
So, you know, and I tell them, look, you know, you can do that with something that's trivial and unimportant, like the products coming out of Cupertino for Apple. I mean, those things don't do anything. I mean, yes, you can talk on them, and they're cool, and they look nice, but they're made in a slave factory in China. So who cares? They're not.
Yeah, but you hardly ever hear of leaks. I mean, never.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
You know, an apple gets left in a bar somewhere, but beyond that, you know, there's
exactly.
a bullet. There's
yeah,
a bullet
the
on the table with your name.
Is that, you know, for all our vaunted technology, and this is one of the things I was talking with a lot of these folks about at this meeting out in this island in the Pacific, is that, yes, we have some cool communication devices and smartphones and computers, but guess what? We're plugging them into a coal-fired power grid that is this creaky thing that is from the late 1800s and early 1900s in terms of its concept. So I said, you know, we're on the one hand, we have one foot sort of in the future with the internet and all these electronics, but most of our balance is tilted into this early industrial age fossil fuel world that really should have run its course many, many decades ago. And
but
so,
it hasn't. It hasn't.
And the problem is that you have so many powerful vested interests that don't want to see that change happen. And it becomes a really easy thing to understand once you understand that it's a massive amount of geopolitical power behind the current system. I mean, even the whole Middle East situation, Art. I mean, we use the buzzword in Washington of our vital national security interests. That's what you hear over. It's a mantra. Well, what that really means is oil. O-I-L. I mean, what's
right.
over there? I mean, you know, date palms and goats and whatever.
I agree with you. It's oil.
I mean, and there's Israel, but Israel has 300 nuclear weapons. Believe me, they can take care of themselves.
Right. All right, so it's oil. I do agree with that, and I do agree that there would be so much interest in keeping oil and the money from oil to ourselves. Not that we do. We ship a lot of it to our enemies. But there's so much serious interest in oil revenue continuing as it has been that I'm sure that people's lives wouldn't be much. I mean, if they got in the way, then there's the bullet with your name on it.
Well, you know, and this is the whole thing that they discovered with, you know, Gore Vidal wrote the foreword to this book years ago called Into the Buzzsaw, where they studied various journalists who started to drill down on some really sensitive things, and they would either be fired or they would disappear or they died mysteriously. It's a fantastic book. It's actually a mainstream book. And what you find when you look into this is that this is an issue that's much bigger than ENSCOM or any of the things that led to those sort of events happening. That Gore Vidal was talking about. And I think that now we're talking about it isn't just money and oil. It's the macroeconomic system, and that would change. For imagine if every village or home or business had its own so-called zero-point or quantum vacuum generator that would pull energy out of the... Okay, and suddenly you have all of India and China and the developing world, so what used to be called the third world, being able to be lifted up out of poverty. But what would happen is that there would be a relative diminution, a reduction in the centralized power of the current world system. And so this is really what it's about. I remember years ago, the admiral in charge of CONUS, Continental United States Security, told our military team and the people who worked with me for years trying to walk me through this system that his job was really maintaining the status quo of the world energy supply.
Okay, let me play devil's advocate for just a second and say, all right, doctor, let's imagine for a second that that this switch did occur. What if I were to suggest to you that the economic disruption from suddenly cutting the oil spigot, no longer needing oil, would be so great that the economic collapse we just went through would be child's play? I'm just playing devil's advocate, but I'm sure there are people who believe that, right?
Oh, there are, and I think that there's some merit to that, and I'm not going to disagree with the fact that had these technologies been transitioned in 80 years ago, we wouldn't be in the jackpot we're in now. But what are we going to wait for? Both polar ice caps to melt and for us to go to World War III in the South China Sea over oil? I mean, at a certain point, we're going to have to decide to transition out of the 1800s to early 1900s industrial era into the future. Now,
well, maybe, but I am telling you right now, before you go on, yeah. Doctor, you're talking about, for example, the Spratly Islands, right, which are near the Philippines. Let me tell you something.
Right.
The United States right now is putting naval and air forces, or about to, back in the Philippines. So,
I know that.
Yeah, so what do you think they imagine is going to happen? I think they imagine that if necessary, we're going to protect the Spratlys, by God.
Right, and I think this gets into the question also of what they're discovering in the oil reserves that are there, you know, in the South China Sea and other areas that are falling already into dispute. This is a problem that's going to just go on and on and on unless we deal with it. The other point I make is it isn't as if someone's going to come out with one of these technologies and they're going to wave a magic wand, and your car and my car are going to have an engine different from what's in it. It's about a 15-year turnover time on heavy, and not the tech, not an iPhone or a smartphone, but when you're talking about someone's engine or someone's electric power grid, you're not going to do that. You're not going to turn that massive ship on a dime. You're turning a massive super tanker that takes 5 miles to turn around. So I think that when you look at that, there's about a 15 to 20 year period of transition that we have if that technology were to come out today. And I think that if it's done in an intelligent way, I think if it's done in a way that allows for a soft landing out of the fossil fuel economy into this new high tech sector. And this was my argument that I had all these leaders.
Yeah, but I don't know how you do that. Hold on, doctor. We're going to take a break here, and then we'll talk about a soft landing.
Right.
I can't imagine a soft landing. He's talking about an economic soft landing. In other words, if something came out that essentially was free energy, 0 point, whatever you want to call it, and it got out, and you could have a little black box. This is just sort of my imagination, a little black box in the back of your home, and it would take care of all your energy needs. There's no way that I see a soft landing there. And if there is, when we get back, we'll let the doctor describe it to us, but I just can't. That's a hard landing. How would you like to boost your Wi-Fi signal at home, in your truck, or in your RV? And when I say boost, I'm not talking about a trivial amount. The Super USB Wi-Fi Antenna 3, invented by the Seagrain Company, doesn't just improve it. It drives it through the roof. It'll improve the Wi-Fi signal on your computer. Users can receive signals hundreds of feet away or more, depending on how you place it. It's an amazing device. It'll increase signal bars on your computer. It works indoors or outdoors. If you put it outdoors, it really cranks. Water resistant, plugs right into your computer's USB port. That's it. Installation is snap, and performance will blow your mind. Easy to install software is included. As I mentioned, comes with a 15-foot USB cable. So if you can get it to a window, suction cup to the window, and if there's any free Wi-Fi out there, you're about to get it. I'm telling you, this thing cranks. Call Seagrain right now and order one. It's only $99.95. It's worth every penny. I use them. I've got one in the RV, one in the house. They're mind-blowing, really. Call Seagrain right now at 800-522-8863. That's 800-522-8863. 8863. Grab a catalog if you like. Oh, listen to this bumper music. I've heard this. I know I've heard this. Anyway, we'll be back in a moment. I don't know. I'm confused. I don't see, Doctor, how we're going to come out of this, and you're welcome to explain, with a soft landing. But go right ahead.
Well, it's relative. I'm comparing this transition or soft landing to a sort of an existential terminus where we run up, you know, where it's Mad Max under the Thunderdome. We're fighting over the last barrel of oil, and we have both polar ice caps have disappeared, and vast areas of the land masses are underwater, et cetera, and so on. So, you know, which is going to be harder? I mean, if we came together as a people and said, look, this is something we need to disclose, the fact we're not alone in the universe. We need to figure out how to make peaceful contact with these civilizations. We haven't talked about that. And we have to figure out how to bring these technologies that have been bottled up for so long, that are at the root of the secrecy behind UFOs, out in a way that is as least disruptive as possible. Now, my view on this, and this is something which, of course, people would disagree with me on, is that we have to do it because it's the only possible out. I mean, my farm here in Virginia runs on solar, but it's not a practical solution for the average person because it's enormously expensive. It's the largest private solar farm in Virginia.
I do the same thing here. I know. Very expensive.
Yeah, and so, but I'm trying to walk the walk to the extent I can. But I think that if you're looking at the planet and you're looking strategically down the road, not the next quarterly return report at Goldman Sachs, but I'm looking, you know, 5, 10, 20, 30 years down, that if we began to bring this information and technology out in a way that focused on the energy generation component and not the propulsive part. But by propulsion, I'm talking about the anti-grav stuff.
Oh,
because,
yes.
All right, so now this gets into this whole controversy. I had a meeting a couple years ago in Washington, and the head of the, what we euphemistically called the Future Technologies of the Air Force, this colonel, which means technologies they already have. And he got into this discussion with me about the weaponization of these delivery systems where you're going very, very fast using this kind of gravity control technology that we have in classified projects. By the way, a lot of the so-called UFOs that people see zipping around near Edwards and Nellis Air Force Base, so-called Area 51, are actually, and up there in Provo at the Dugway Proving Grounds, those are actually man-made EMGs, electromagnetic gravitic.
By the way, Doctor, were you shocked beyond belief when the government recently said Area 51 is real?
Well, no, because they said, no, it's real. But at the same time, they said, of course, nothing in that critical is going on there, and it's just conventional stuff. But,
yeah,
you know, the area that you're concerned about at that facility is Pahoot Mesa and Groom Lake and S-4, S-9, S-12. And the really state-of-the-art facilities, like I said, are up in Utah outside of Provo at the Dugway Proving Grounds.
I've heard that, but who knows what to believe? I mean, both areas are, well, let's put
well,
it
I have
way.
Folks who've been in
you can't go
places.
Visit.
Well, no, you can. In fact, there are no roads into this particular area at Dugway, and the airspace over it's restricted and classified. So there you have it.
Have you seen the signs that say lethal force authorized? You don't go past that.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I've been out there, and you don't. And so obviously you get the same thing in the outback of at Pine Gap in Australia. In fact, I'm looking at a fantastic photograph of Pine Gap right now that a guy who worked there just sent to me last week. You know, what you find is that there are all these sort of facilities that don't get talked about a lot. And then, of course, you know, 40 years after the heyday of Area 51, which was back in the 60s, by the way, the government says, oh, well, it does exist. Well, yeah. Okay, so by the time they acknowledge it, it's probably everything's been moved of any criticality.
Maybe. Maybe. I don't know.
It's all underground
There's so many mind games going on that who knows.
It's all underground. Everything important is underground. Nothing's above the surface. If it's important, it's subterranean.
Have you ever, Doctor, had anybody tell you where the beings from the crash at Roswell, are they or were they at 51 or were they sent out to Ohio or, you know, where?
Well, the ones, first of all, there was apparently one that lived. And right. Okay, and the most that particular bean was moved, from my understanding, to various bases over the years, and I have a witness who actually saw it at Camp Perry in Virginia, believe it
really?
Or not. In a, yeah, okay. So who actually on a deathbed confessional and in the video, which we have, talked about this. But, of course, the others being deceased, and I know that the in subsequently there were a number of kind of Tesla coil types, type EMP, electromagnetic pulse weapons, that were developed between 1945 and the 60s that were able to target these vehicles when they would be in this dimension. We can talk about this if you wish, and would be able to hit them. And so at Fort Huachuca, if you go to Arizona and you go to Tombstone, there's a place called Fort Huachuca, which is actually Army Intelligence Headquarters. And there is an underground facility there. A man that's on my team had worked in there, and he reported that there were 9 separate ET craft and various bodies that have been autopsied that were in storage there. So I think it's been dispersed, and over the years it's been in a number of locations.
Okay, move back for a second to a soft landing. I mean, as I mentioned, if there was a little black box at the corner of your house and you had an energy source that would keep you going, keep your house warm and toasty in the winter and cool in the summer and all the rest of it, it would take care of your energy needs. I just don't see how you get a soft landing.
Well, I think it's going to be, as I said, I'm using it relatively soft. I mean, compared to the alternative, which is cataclysmic. But no,
yes.
I think at this point it's going to be a difficult transition because it's been delayed. The analogy I use is that, you know, you got a leak in your roof and you put it off month after month and year after year, and eventually the whole structure of the house starts to rot and fall in. So, yes, we should have dealt with this issue a long time ago. And I remember sitting, there was an old, you probably remember who this guy was. I'm not know if a lot of your listeners will, but Senator Barry Goldwater, who ran for president in the 60s. And he was also an Air Force general. And he knew about this just because he knew some pilots that had encounters with these UFOs at fairly close range. And he was also friends with General Curtis LeMay, who he of course, it was back in those days, it was bombing back to the Stone Age LeMay, because he was advocating using nuclear bombs and into China back then. But at any rate, I'm sitting in Barry Goldwater's living room. This is a hilarious story in a way. And Barry Goldwater, and I had an assistant with me, and he had left the Senate, and of course John McCain took his seat. And I'm sitting in Barry Goldwater's living room, and his wife is there. They're in Paradise Valley, there in the Phoenix area. And we start talking about this, and you know, and he was, you know, this guy was, he wasn't at all religious, I'll tell you that. He was conservative, but in the libertarian sort of way. And every other word was a cuss word. And I'm sitting in his living room, and he said, Dr. Greer, is a goddamn mistake then and a goddamn mistake now that any of this was kept secret. And I, I said, yes, you're right. And we started talking about this. I said, well, what inquiries have you made, Senator? And he said, well, he asked General LeMay to get him into the so-called Blue Room at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base there back years ago, because he was friends with Curtis LeMay, and he was an Air Force general, and Goldwater was an Air Force general in the Air Force Reserves. And Curtis LeMay turned to him and said, God damn it, Barry, I can't even get into that area anymore. And if you ever ask me about this again, I will see that you are court-martialed out of the Air Force.
I've heard that.
I'm sitting, and this is from Barry Goldwater's lips to my ears, and I have a witness to this. And I asked Senator Goldwater, I said, was Curtis LeMay serious? He said he was serious as a heart attack, and he never inquired about this again.
Do you know there may be a recording of that? There actually may be a recording of that or something very similar. I actually heard it. But again, I've got to drag you right back to this soft landing. If you had zero energy in your hand, Doctor, I mean in your hand.
Right.
And you had not yet been presented with a bullet with your name on it.
Well,
how would you how would you introduce it into society in some way that wouldn't crash the economy?
I think that it's, you know, you have to define crash the economy. I think that will there be a big hit on the futures markets for oil and commodities? Yes. But the trend,
a monstrous hit.
There'll be a big hit. But at the same time, we're taking a big hit now. I mean, let's get out of our, you know, a Eurocentric and American view for 1 minute and look at the fact that 48% of the population of the world doesn't even have indoor plumbing, doesn't have a pot to pee in, the proverbial pot to pee in.
Right.
So if you look, I mean, in a sense, we're living through an economic catastrophe now. We've just been insulated from it because we've been gobbling up all the fossil fuels and resources for decades. But if so, but in the rest of the world, you have unspeakable poverty in India and China and South America and all over the world. I travel all
been
over
there.
The world, and you've seen
I
it.
Do too. I've
and,
seen
and
it.
And so, you know, I think if we look at this and get out of our own sort of narcissistic, ethnocentric viewpoint, we'll begin. We see that we're actually
wait a minute. That's a synonym for exceptionalism, isn't it?
Well, no, I think we can be exceptional in a way that doesn't have to be stupid and narcissistic. And I think okay. this gets into, you know, what does real leadership consist of? By the way, this meeting I was at in the middle of the Pacific Ocean was a leadership conference for all these folks. And I said, here's the leadership that we need. People with the courage to disclose this information, lead the way to bring this out, and figure out how to transition into a new economy. And I said, will it be easy? No. But, you know, rebuilding after World War II wasn't easy. And so I think that it's a question of not only does it have to happen, because the alternative is cataclysmic in my view, but it needs to happen, the sooner the better, because the longer we put off this transition, the more difficult the landing's going to be. It's going to be harder and harder and harder, not easier. So I think that gets into the problem is that, you know, instead of, you know, you look in the 1920s, there were about 2 billion people on the planet. Now
right.
there are 7. So, and if these technologies had been allowed to begin to come out from the minds of inventors and not been gobbled up by J.P. Morgan and other people, which did happen, we would have had this transition 80 years ago. But we didn't. But now, of course, in every generation of people in power think that, oh, well, let's kick this can down the road. And this you see a lot with a lot of problems in Washington. Let's kick it down the road and kick it down the road. But now
if we couldn't do it then, which you just told us, and you're allowing that it would be much, much harder to do it now, and that it's infinitely harder now,
yep.
How are we ever going to get it out?
Well, but we have something now that didn't exist 10 years ago, and
that
is the fact that a huge percentage of the world's population, even people who don't have indoor plumbing, have the internet. And I think that if you get the information and you get the technology out, once you have an operating system that works, it's going to be very hard to stop it.
So maybe what you have to do, doctor, is get the information, get the schematics, and suddenly just sort of fire it to every news outlet in the whole world and then run like hell.
Yes. Well, if my group could develop something that could get independently tested this way, and where I knew that it wasn't a false alert, we would do exactly that. But more importantly, get it into the hands of a whole lot of different engineers all over the world who reproduce it. And this is why you have to bypass this sort of secrecy, patent avenue, intellectual property route, because that's going to be your Achilles heel. Absolutely.
Okay. All right. So let's get it on the record. Do you have that information now?
Well, you know, it's hard for me to say if I have that information.
Mm-hmm.
Here's what I will tell you. I have a lot of I have a disk with a lot of confiscated patents and information on it that was given to me by someone who was being courted by the CIA. And are any of those systems that would actually work as advertised? I don't know, because A, I'm not an engineer, and B, I don't have a laboratory to put these things to the test. And that's the whole problem. It's a chicken egg issue. The people who I know who have had some of these systems end up getting intimidated And now here's a true story that people say it's apocryphal, but it's absolutely true. There's a man that is a physicist who was at Lawrence Berkeley Labs, and he had, and I know the CIA doesn't like me to say this, but he had a barium titanate crystal, with, and he had a voltage wire wrapped around it and voltage going into it, and at a certain frequency, resonant frequency, and an output signal that was 10 times more wattage, real power, than the input. Well, in comes some goons, and he was not patenting this. He was doing an experiment at Lawrence Berkeley Labs, which is in the Bay Area. And in come these guys. They confiscate his system. They actually take him and put him in a mental hospital and put him on a Thorazine drip and do all kinds of stuff. Now, this man is one of the sweetest people you'd ever meet. But, you know, is he going to try to pull this stunt by himself again? No. This is why we're telling people, we're trying to put the people together to create an energy research lab where we can do this as safely as we can, but that's being observed on the internet in real time. And I think that's a very different approach to how most people would develop a technology like this. And
well,
I actually
the Thorazine says, shh.
Yeah, well, the Thorazine just says, you know, he's in a stupor. It's a terrible drug. But yeah, I think that this is how, you know, suppression has happened in a million different ways. And as I look at it, if we're going to make a difference into the future, we're going to have to figure out how to not make these same mistakes over and over again.
Can we?
Yes, I think we can, but we're going to have to pull our resources and involve the public in a very large way. I don't think it can be done, as I said earlier, in a small way at isolated people working on this as lone wolves. This is why what our plan is to put together a research and development a laboratory where all this is being done very open and open source, frankly, and put that together with some of the most brilliant engineers and physicists that we've identified over the last 15 years and make a run at this. And,
well,
you know, would that be a risky thing to do? Yeah, it'd be a risky thing to do, but I think it's riskier to sit on our hands and do nothing.
All right, you said you had, a DVD or a CD or a computer full of many of these type things. Do you think you've got the goods in there? Is it your guess
that was yes? Yes. I think that if we could put together a research team, probably within 12 to 24 months, we'd have an operating system out that would do as what we're discussing. The reason for that is that we've studied so many different breakthroughs that have happened over the years. For example, we've identified the people who worked directly with this guy named Stan Meyer, who had a car that was running on water because he had an electronic system that was actually pulling energy out of the zero-point field so that he could dissociate hydrogen and oxygen out of water and run a car on it. This was
Are you aware there's a fellow in the Philippines, no joke, who is driving a car around Manila that runs on water?
Well, you know, I've heard of these, and a few of them we've looked into, and they end up not being as advertised. But if that's true, that's great. What I say to people is that it doesn't help if you have one guy running around the Philippines on this. You've got to move it into the mass public. And I think that that's – but now, did Stan Meyer actually have that? Yes, but if you look at his patents, he altered the frequencies of the hertz, the cycles per second, and the resonant frequencies so that no one could do it. Well, of course, the whole point of a patent is to create something that would be protected, and you can put all the information in there. But he didn't. And so when he died, mysteriously and very suddenly, back in 1996, I believe, what he left was a lot of material which we were trying to get, and ended up a big corporation came in and bought it out from under us, from his estate. Now, one of the things he had in there was a toroid. It looks like a donut. And it had a magnetically charged fluid in it, and that was definitely so-called free energy. And it had a national security order on it. But three of the people who worked with Stan Meyer are still living. We've identified them, and they would love to work in a research lab like this. So what I've said to people is that a lot of our work has been to collect the information, but more importantly, the people who understand the principles and the physics. Now, how do you put them together? in a way that they can, you know, as safely as possible, work on something like this and live to see tomorrow. That's what we're trying to do now at this phase of our project.
Living to see tomorrow. That's good. All right, hold it right there. Here's where we're going to take a break for a moment and a deep breath. Free energy. How would you do it, folks, so that it was a soft landing? You know, that the economy didn't do what it did back in 06 or whatever. So we'd all live happily. Welcome back, and here we go. I'm still not clear on a soft landing. I just don't know how you do this kind of thing. Piecemeal. I just don't get it.
And, well, I don't know. It wouldn't be. It wouldn't be piecemeal, but it and, you know, maybe soft landing is not the correct term, but I think it's a relative term, as I said, compared to what we're facing if we don't deal with this issue. And
by when?
You know, and I think it, well, I think it should have been done decades ago. So as soon as possible is all I can say.
Well, yeah, but if you look at the current oil-based economy and you look at oil disappearing and getting more expensive, there's going to be a dollar figure. I mean, eventually you're going to be able to pin it to a dollar figure. By the time it's $15 a gallon, $20 a gallon, somewhere right in there is a breaking point.
Well, and actually, what would actually happen with this information even coming out on a proof of principle system where it was widely known around the world is that oil would begin to trend down very steeply because all those markets are anticipatory. All the futures markets and commodity
That's
trading
right.
market, they would begin to factor that into the value of oil. Right mm-hmm. now, the value of oil has a couple of premiums on it. You have the war premium, the chaos in the Middle East. And you know, China industrializing at you know 8%, 10%, 12% a year. It's slowing down right now a little bit. It's eased up, but in over the long haul, that's the kind of problem we're facing. And I think this all this does is build in the likelihood of growing disparities between the wealthy and the unfortunate, and that's a prescription. If you look at history, for revolution and turmoil. So I think the sooner that we can come together as a people to transition out of those systems into something practical, and by practical, I'm not knocking solar and wind. It's just not a very practical, energy-dense solution for a planet with 7 billion people.
No, it's getting better. Here in Nevada and in California, we've got these new solar collectors. I don't know if you've seen them.
Oh, yes.
Very large towers with hundreds and thousands of reflectors pointed at the tower, and they're getting to be fairly efficient.
Yes, but you know, you're talking about that one facility there on the near the California Nevada border, costing in the $2 billion range. Well, my God, mm-hmm. I mean, the money they put into that, you could have developed these other technologies and begin to have them coming out like sausages off the conveyor belt.
You can throw billions of dollars around, but you know, check out the price of the last war we were in.
Yeah, well, yeah, that was a couple $1 trillion if you factor all the aspects of it in, and
that's a lot of mirrors.
Yeah, it is, and I think that, you know, there are solutions, but ultimately they're going to be too little, too late. That's my concern, and I think it's a temporizing strategy to utilize those. I think the real solutions are these ones that have been resisted because they are. In my view, they're transformative. In the view of the conventional wisdom, they're disruptive. And I think that depending on where you're sitting on which side of the fence, it is disruptive. And, you know, it's interesting. A few years ago, back when W was the president of the United States, I was meeting with his sort of consigliere on energy and nuclear power, and it was this Harvard law guy. And we're sitting at the university club there up the street from the White House. And you know, this is a place you see Rumsfeld and all these folks in there. And he's telling me that anybody who becomes president or someone in a very powerful corporate position, no matter whether they're left or right or center or liberal or conservative and all these labels, they don't mean anything. He says basically they get into those positions and they govern and make policies that are very conservative in the traditional sense of not having big change happen. And the reason for that is that they don't want to supervise something this big. You know, I mean, this is such a big change. If you add up all the changes that have happened since the 1850s to now, the disclosure of this information would dwarf all of them added together in terms of the way it would change the way we're living on this planet. Now, to me, that's needed, and it's a good thing, and it's been forestalled for too long. But if you're in a position where you're just trying to maintain the status quo, you know, you look at the edge, you go to the edge of this precipice, and you're going to go, good God, I'm not taking this leap. So
well, if they don't act pretty soon, they're going to be supervising billions of people starving to death. They're going to be supervising wars that are going to be so out of control that it'll be the end anyway. So,
well, see, this is what I was saying to you earlier, is that from my perspective, any way you slice it, the wise thing to do is to come together and figure out how to bring out these really advanced technologies and physics in a way that is as non-disruptive as possible. Knowing
I don't know what that is. How about a toy?
Yeah, a toy. No, I mean, there's something actually going to run something.
I know, but we're talking about baby steps here. Yeah. If you come out with a toy that seems to demonstrate over unity, believe me, people pay attention to that.
Well, actually, there have been there, and actually, there's right now a tritium battery that's exhibiting this. There are a few small, you know, at the level of lighting an LED that are out there right now. But I think that, you know, it kind of gets lost in the dialogue. And I think to make a change on this, you're going to need to bring out something that the average person is going to see a practical application for it. I think getting back to the secrecy and the ridicule of the UFO subject, the secrecy and the ridicule is rooted in the fact that the implications of this are so huge. It's not because it's silly. I mean, it's been portrayed silly. You know, I have this really it's sort of a funny CIA document from 1953 and it talks about the CIA engaging Disney Studios to make cartoons about ETs and UFOs so that the subject would be the matter of ridicule and mirth and sort of levity instead of being something serious. And yet you have the first CIA director in this letter that I was quoting from earlier in the show talking about how people are soberly concerned about this and understand that this is an enormously important issue. And I think that it's because it has so many implications that it has been ridiculed and has been sort of pigeonholed into the silly season of all things ufological, which, you know,
okay. For a second, let's come back to a serious matter, and that is this question. Are we currently in any sort of productive dialogue with them?
Well, you know, I can't, you know, or when you say we who?
We humans.
I suspect yes. Although not on an official level, what I've learned in studying this and leading teams that attempt to make contact, and is that I think individual humans have had contact experiences. Whether the government at some point had some liaison that then fell apart, that's possible. Although I don't see a great deal of evidence for it. The closest I get is from, you know, after meeting with these guys, these French officials, they sent me a letter from a man who was with Eisenhower when apparently he met with some ETs there at Muroc, which is near where Edwards Air Force Base is now, back, I believe, in April of 1956, if my memory serves me correctly. And so apparently there were some attempts to make this sort of more open contact, but it became very dysfunctional because, you know, the motivations for the dialogue were not what they should have been.
All right. Well, we'll probably never really hear about that. What do you know, Doctor, about ET contact that has occurred at the macro level that you consider to be legitimate?
Well, I think it's happened with many individuals who have had contact experiences with these civilizations.
Oh, yes.
And the individuals. And what I've done, there's something we started back about 20 years ago called the CE5 Initiative, Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind Initiative, is to train people in the concepts of contact and the concepts of so-called remote viewing and the use of consciousness and other technologies to interface with these civilizations. And when we've done that, we've had some really strange but amazing experiences that have happened. And that's been in every spectrum, you know, photographic, video, electronic, and even objects and the beings that are very, very close to us. If you look at on our website under CE5 on the top header at seriousdisclosure.com, you can go through that, and there's some photographs that are pretty unusual of what appear to be ET and trans-dimensional beings that are very near us in places all over the world. So what does that constitute contact? I think it does. And I think the question becomes, why are under the CE5 photos and videos at the bottom of that section, you see all these unusual things, like not far from where you live in Joshua Tree, we were having this strange series of experience where we had these electronics set up, and all of a sudden we start getting these signals through all these electronics. And then we see this, what looks like a sphere appear in the desert there in the middle of Joshua Tree National Park, and there are about 30, 40 of us there. And this thing floats over and then disappears, and then you start hearing in thin air, there's nothing there, what sound like some people talking. Now, it was in English. And so a member of our team took a camera, and you can see these photographs, and there's this being kind of floating almost in a holographic light area right outside where our chairs were. This is an actual photograph, waving at us. And this being has a huge head, has concave areas on the skull, is there. And many people who were there were having other kinds of unusual experiences in consciousness, electronically, and what have you. And I think one of the things that people, when they begin to have this sort of experience, have to understand is if you're dealing with an actual ET, it's going to be strange. Why? Because if they're moving beyond the speed of light from one star system to another, they're dropping out of linear space-time and traversing other dimensions into this point in space and time. So right. They are all, by definition, a priori, they are all trans-dimensional or interdimensional and ET. I remember Jacques Vallée and I had this discussion once where he said, well, are they ET or are they interdimensional? I said, well, they're both. I mean, if it was just something like the spirit world or a ghost, they don't need a spacecraft that materializes and lands at Rendlesham Forest Air Force Base.
No, they'd have that ability or they couldn't even get here.
Yeah, so this gets into this whole discussion of a whole new understanding of physics and space and time, where you have enfolded within any, say, volume of 3D, other dimensions that you can traverse through to get from one star system to another. And this is what they're doing. And so when they do appear, it can be very unusual. They can appear and then disappear, or they can be partially in this dimension where it almost looks like a hologram or some translucent circular or disc or triangular shaped object. And in fact, one of the top secret witness guys we just put up from the Air Force was at Altus Air Force Base in Oklahoma back years ago when one of these objects appeared over the hot nuclear area of this Air Force Base. And you could see it. It was like a cobalt blue, but it was translucent. It wasn't fully in this dimension, but it was moving over this area where our planes were loaded with hot nuclear weapons to take off in an emergency, and all the alarms went off. So it was enough in this dimension, and yet it could go straight through. It was not solid, so it could pass straight through these aircraft. And of course, in World War II, everybody knows the group the Foo Fighters. Well, guess where they got their name? Foo Fighters, Dave Grohl got that from. We brought up this information about in World War II, there were these objects that were called Foo Fighters that were like that, that were flying around our aircraft. Hitler thought it was a secret Allied weapon. Mm-hmm. We thought it was a secret Nazi weapon. Now, a member of my team, Dr. Altshuler in Denver, very renowned hematologist, pathologist, wonderful man, passed away of cancer a few years ago. He was General Jimmy Doolittle's nephew. And Jimmy Doolittle, the general, a famous general of World War II, told him, look, I was sent over there by Roosevelt to look into what these Foo Fighters were. And So he goes over there and comes back to the White House and tells President Roosevelt, FDR, that they are, and I'm quoting, they are interplanetary vehicles, but they were behaving in this unusual way. Now, that is a 100% true story. So this is now goes all the way back before Truman to FDR. And these Foo Fighters that were reported in the European Theater of Operations, I'm sure they must have been seen in Asia as well, were very unusual because sometimes they'd be fully materialized, but often they would be in this form where they're partially in this 3D and partially not, and they would literally come straight through some of our aircraft. And so, of course, I mean, this is the 1940s, and people are completely perplexed. I mean, most people would be perplexed by this today in 2013, but certainly in the 40s they were perplexed. And yet, that's how far back we know that there were these sort of really well-known and high-level military encounters that were getting reported back to the chain of command.
All right, well, let me ask you what everybody asks about this, and that is that, okay, a long, long history of attempts at contact and so forth and so on. So the gigantic question that everybody asks is if they want contact, then why not the White House lawn or the equivalent thereof and anywhere else in the world? Why not?
Well, you know, it was funny. That's what Larry King asked me. And I said, look, first of all, who's White House? You know, the one in Bogota, Colombia, or the one in Washington, D.C.?
Yeah, whatever.
All right, number one. Number two, they'd be blown out of the sky. Number three, I think
now, hold on. How do we blow them out of the sky? They cross dimensions to get here. Surely, you know, one of our hellfires or whatever we're going to use probably isn't going to work.
Well, no, but these electromagnetic weapons do when they're in this dimension. And this is another whole discussion of what kind of covert technologies exist. Everyone assumes that our technologies have stood still, and the most advanced thing we have is a cruise missile. I mean, you know, from the 70s or 80s. I mean, this is
good point.
Nonsense. And I think that the bigger question is, no one can know this for certain, but my reading of this, having gone out for thousands of hours under the skies with people, looking at the stars, looking at objects that come in, is that they're actually, I think they're waiting for us. I think the ball is in our court. Everyone thinks that somehow they're going to behave the way we might, and that is just come in there and land on the White House lawn. I think that it, in reality, it's sort of a cosmic Rorschach test, how you view this. And the way I view this is that they're actually waiting for us to awaken to their reality in a way that is peaceful and doesn't create any more chaos than we already have on this planet, number one. And number two, that we approach them in a way that is not militarized and weaponized. And I think so our approach to it has been all wrong. Now, I think another question is, a lot of what people are asking for has already happened. There was an event in Montreal, I believe it was 1990, where one of these objects was over downtown Montreal for a very long time and was seen by many people. The events in Belgium in between 1989 and 92, there were tens of thousands of people that would see these objects hovering over cities and over towns and what have you. And it did make it a little bit into the media. And so this gets into another question. Why should they force the issue if we want to be so dysfunctional that we keep lying to each other about this? What is going on? And I think to the extent that we facilitate disclosure, to that extent it is saying to them, to the visitors, that we're ready to acknowledge their presence. So I think that it's actually, it's more like a cosmic mirror. The way that you respond to this whole issue says more about ourselves or yourself than it does about these civilizations. And I think they're wise enough and patient enough to see if we can begin to get this right.
All right, Doctor, I know you had a number of programs trying to initiate contact, and you did that years ago.
No, we're still doing it.
How productive was it? What did you do?
Well, we still are doing it, and they've been very productive. That's why I tell people go to the website and go to the CE5 section, they'll see that. And there's a book that we have released not too long ago called Contact, Countdown to Transformation, that goes through all the dozens of events that have happened. And they're like this one in Joshua Tree. Some have amazing photographic and electronic evidence. Others have been very transitory. But what I've concluded from it is that they're willing to make contact with groups of people if people approach them in a way that is peaceful and you're not running around like chickens with your head cut off.
Okay, but after great. You've got contact, you get productive dialogue. I mean, we're talking about energy here and all kinds of things that they could potentially tell us, which are very, very valuable to the human race. So if you get contact, how do you progress from that to dialogue?
Well, I don't think you're sitting there having a cup of coffee speaking English. I think it happens on a level that's some would call it very metaphysical or paranormal. I don't call it that. In consciousness with remote viewing and at that level. Whether it progresses to another level, we'll see. I think on that level, it's happened to many, many, many people who've been on our teams. My own experience with this dates back to when I was a teenager, is that it was very highly in that area of the science of consciousness and the understanding of how the mind and consciousness is the ultimate field of energy and non-locality. And they seem to understand that. And so I think that most of the contact that has happened up to this point isn't a sort of a verbal discussion or a sort of translatable language so much as it is on that level.
So you're saying that our consciousness has got to be raised, and we're at some point there'll be a dialogue when we get to their level.
Well, not to their level necessarily, but certainly
close.
And we have had that dialogue, but it's been on the level of consciousness and remote viewing. And for those of you people who don't know that term, it's the ability to access consciousness in its non-local form and see remote places or remote points in space or time. Now, one of the things that our film deals with, the film Sirius, S-I-R-I-U-S, is that it deals with this question of, is our own individual consciousness, is it actually what we think it is? In other words, we associate it with just our egos and our individualities, but is there an aspect of our consciousness that's operating in sort of a field that isn't bound or limited by space and time? And the answer to that is yes, and the science on it is actually quite clear. You know, Einstein talked about the spooky effect and the spooky phenomenon, where you do something with a proton in one point in space and it's mirrored in another point. They've now discovered mirror neurons. Recently, they found that actually in experiments with rats, that there's precognition and reactions that happen. And on the cellular level, so there's all this sort of phenomenon that has to do with consciousness and the mind.
I think it does as well. I'm convinced that it does.
And the ET contact experiences seem to be where that intersects with these visitors from other star systems. They understand that because, let's face it, you're not going to communicate across multiple light years of space using an electromagnetic signal from AT&T that's traveling at the speed of light. It would take thousands of years to get the signal there and back. So you're dealing.
And if you did, you'd probably get a dropped call.
You'd get a dropped call. So in this case, you're dealing with something that a concept I came up with, which may be too controversial to go into here, back in the 90s, called consciousness-assisted technologies and technology-assisted consciousness. And what I discovered through some experiences I had is that these civilizations have the equivalent of a communication device that interfaces directly with coherent, clear thought from individuals, and that the ETs actually, when they are navigating their craft or communicating, are hooking their own consciousness and thought through these systems that go at what have been called scalar signals that are multiples of the speed of light, but that interface up with thought and consciousness. So it works both ways. There's consciousness assisting the technology where the individual is interfacing with the technology of the spacecraft or the communication device, but they also have technologies that augment or project their own thought and consciousness. And it works both directions. And in 1991, when I wrote this in a paper, I had a senior aerospace scientist call me from McDonnell Douglas, which is now part of Boeing. He said, "How do you know this?" He says, because they had discovered the same thing in some research they were doing at McDonnell Douglas, because old man McDonald was really into all this. And I said, from an experience I had when I was a teenager with these visitors, that was quite clear to me that they had that ability. And he said, "Well, you're correct." And he said, "But you know it." And ultimately, this begins to be the bigger question of a paradigm that we're going to go through. This huge shift. It's not just an energy generation, and are we alone in the universe? But ultimately, it's opening a doorway, I think, into who are we, and you know, what does it really mean to have the potential of a human being? And I think that potential is amazing because it includes not only the ability to travel interstellar, but to experience states of consciousness that take you through other dimensions, and understanding that in a very clear way, where it becomes scientific and where the scientific evidence builds. And, you know, the physicist Goswami wrote The Self-Aware Universe, and I don't know if you've read that book, but and Edgar Mitchell, who's an astronaut that I've worked with, who founded the Noetic Sciences Institute, and they've done a lot of study on how mind and consciousness and thought are actually not limited by, you know, your brainwave activity or just your body. And that there is this element. I think that that's why when you talk about contact with these civilizations, you're going to have to then add in this other area of exploration of the science of consciousness and understanding of a new type of physics that is awareness.
Well, you may be onto something there. You mentioned Edgar Mitchell. I've had him on the show, of course, and maybe you've got some comment on this, but I thought it one of the oddest things, and since you brought up his name, I'll mention it. He walked on the moon, and I got to interview him.
Yes.
And it was an odd interview in the sense that when I asked him to relate his feelings, his mindset, what he thought of, what he saw, what he felt, any senses that he could give to me at all about his experience walking on the moon, he couldn't. He actually couldn't. And I found that disturbing, and I've never gotten over it, Dr. Greer. Have you ever spoken to him about that?
Yeah, I have, but I mean, it was in his backyard, and I mean, he explained it as something that was really transformative in consciousness, and where he could, you know, hold up his hand and the whole earth would vanish. And it was a very mind-expanding, a beautiful experience that led him to founding the Noetic Sciences Institute. And so I think that maybe it was, you know, he just wasn't comfortable speaking of it on that level and it, you know, on your show. But you know, I'm sure he was very affected by his experience there.
Well, one would think that that would be an experience that would be so imprinted that when you're asked for it, the way asked about it, the way I asked about it, you would just bubble up with everything that you remembered about it. All, you know, and I just wanted the easy stuff. You know, what it felt like when you stepped, what things right. looked like, what you thought about while you were seeing all of this, and he just really couldn't relate it. Now, maybe it was just that interview in that moment, but it was right. that question and it was that answer. He said, "You know, Art, it's a funny thing. I really can't remember much about it." And I just thought that was amazing.
That's interesting. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, what he shared with me was more this sort of effect it had on him as opposed to any sort of other details. But I do know that when Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong were there, that there were UFOs that were gathered around the crater where we landed. And this is not a myth. And I've had it confirmed to me by my multiple independent folks. And one of the reasons that Neil Armstrong did not appear in public much is that he did not want to deceive through the secrecy the public on what really happened. He was very uncomfortable with that, and that's why he became kind of reclusive and gave very few public appearances. appearances during his lifetime after he landed on the moon in 1969. And I think that, you know, Buzz Aldrin, you know, had a hard time coping with it also, and I've had members of his family confirm to me that, in fact, he had the same experience, but that he wasn't allowed to speak about it. And it's really unfortunate. You know, ironically, my uncle, who worked at Grumman and worked on the lunar module, passed away 2 weeks after Neil Armstrong did. And but I think it's sort of an open secret in some circles that, in fact, when we first landed on the moon, we weren't alone. And it's certainly known through the Disclosure Project witnesses we have that when we went up there to before the lunar landing, we had something called the Lunar Orbiter that went around and we took the early digital photographs.
That's right.
And there were structures there. And Carl Wolf and other people we have in our Disclosure Project, you know, saw at this NSA facility that was at Langley Air Force Base in Virginia, these images that were clearly showing very old structures on the moon, but also some newer ones. And the structures were in the area called the Terminator, which is the area between the dark and the light part of the moon. It's sort of the twilight area because the moon is sort of fixed and where it is, where you see the light side, the sun hitting one side of it. But I think that this is why when we landed on the moon, they were prepared for the possibility or the likelihood that we may not be alone. And people have asked me, did we actually go to the moon? Yes, we did. But was all the footage that of what happened shown to the public? Absolutely not. It was not shown. And I do know people who have seen that footage, who've been in these classified programs. They're not willing to come out publicly, but they've described pretty much essentially the same thing, that there were multiple huge UFOs that were flying around, but also around and hovering at the edge of the crater of the Sea of Tranquility where we landed.
And okay, Dr. Greer, you've just about eaten up your 3 hours here, so I think we're going to probably terminate the interview here and go to open lines in a little bit, if that's all right. But you've done a wonderful job. You've just, it's sort of point and click. Somebody points at you and you just go, don't you?
Well, you know, I'm very happy to have the opportunity to share the information we've gathered. And once again, if folks want to see a lot of this evidence and material and documents and witness testimonies, they can go to SiriusDisclosure.com. It's S-I-R-I-U-S Disclosure.com. It's there for anyone to see who wants to look at it. And you know, we're always looking for new people to come forward with more evidence and information. So be in touch.
All right. Thank you, my friend, and we'll do it again.
All right. Thank you.
Take care. All right. That's Dr. Stephen Greer. Really a point-and-click kind of guest, huh? You almost wonder where he takes a breath, but he's got an awful lot of information. This is Dark Matter, and we are going to, for the balance of the program, go to open lines. And what that means is anything you want to talk about is fair game, no screened calls. So if you're ready for that, buckle in. Dark Matter, you're on the air.
Wonderful. Well, my name is Tyrone from Sacramento.
Howdy.
How are you?
Fine. Turn your radio off, please.
You got it. I wanted to make a comment that...
That goes for everybody. Turn your radios off if you're calling.
We had a gentleman that I knew a couple years ago who invented basically a free power machine. And him and his partner basically were souped up by the government and on trumped up charges essentially of mail fraud, is in prison now for 10 years because of the device that he invented. And he talked with me. He was in our church. And just an outstanding man, very, very brilliant and smart. And it's just sad to see this happen, that when people come up with these brilliant ideas, that our government just really doesn't want it to be brought out to the public. And it's just a sad, sad state of affairs. It really is.
Okay, so he's still in jail?
Oh, yeah. He's dying from cancer right now. And his wife about weekly, and I ask, how's he doing? And she goes, well, he'll probably die in there because they're not going to let him out because of the information that he knows. And she knows all about it, but she's going to be very quiet about it.
So you're saying then that what Dr. Greer said about being threatened, about a bullet with your name on it and all of that stuff is true?
Absolutely true. And always I was thinking when I spoke to him, I said, you know, just use it for yourself. Don't go around trying to market it because it's just not the time right now. The timing has to be right. It's a sad thing, you know. I think that idea about the water car that runs on water, I saw that down in the Philippines. It's amazing. I think if we more and more of us would do that, it would really make a change.
It would. All right. Thank you very much. Well, it's true. There is a fellow in the Philippines, and he's actually made his design available, claims that he drives around in a car that runs on water. I certainly don't know how it works. I'm just relating the claim to you. I'm not saying it's true. But we've heard these stories again and again and again. There was another one. Somebody who's in jail, dying in jail right now. Dark Matter, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello, Art. This is James. I'm speaking to you from the southern part of Cebu Island in the Philippines. And I just wanted to let you know that I've been a fan of yours since the early 90s.
Wait a minute. No, wait. How would you be hearing me in the Philippines?
I'm listening to you on my Sirius TKR1 internet radio, and I'm speaking to you over an internet telephone.
Wow.
And I can dial any number in the United States, Canada, and Virgin Islands free from this location.
Wow.
And it cost me $28 a month for the service. And I
actually, it does sound like we're connected. That's amazing.
Yes,
what part of the Philippines are you in?
I'm in the southern section of Cebu Island.
Okay, Cebu.
Right.
Very good.
A delegate. I'm over here for a year. I'll be back home for a couple of months in March of next year. And
My goodness.
So tickled to have you on the radio again. It's just wonderful. And you've blown us out for two nights. It's absolutely incredible.
Well, it's wonderful to hear from the Philippines. You know, I'm kind of sort of almost a little homesick, so.
Oh, yes, I know. I know all about it.
You know, I almost moved to Cebu. I almost bought a house there, actually.
Oh, really?
Oh,
yeah,
yes.
I know when you left and when you set up your antenna and made them take you down and you got permission to set it back up again. I know.
That's a true statement.
Yes.
Okay.
Go ahead, sir.
No, go ahead.
Oh, I just wanted to let you know, I'm so glad you're back on the air. And I listen to you at 10 o'clock in the morning till 2 o'clock in the afternoon here.
Mm-hmm.
This is the 18th. So you know that 12-hour time delay. So
I do.
I'm being ahead. So it's so wonderful to talk to you and keep up the great work for all of us.
And thank you very much. And take care, my friend.
Thank you, sir.
All the way from the Philippines. Wow. I didn't think he was telling us the truth, but he was. That's pretty cool. That's a neat little town, by the way, Cebu. And I very nearly did end up moving there. Wow. Dark Matter, you're on the air. Hello.
Art.
Yes.
This is Greg. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine. Where are you calling from?
Well, right now I'm up in Montana. It's raining.
Okay.
And first off, I'd like to say welcome back from... everybody at Belgab, MV, Bateman, and Saucy Rossi. I think he did some videos for you.
Belgab, indeed. Saucy Rossi, yes. Yes, and oh, and boy, are some of them really good, too. Did you see the last one he did?
We were talking about that on the forum, Art. And when I saw it, I went through such a range of emotions, especially when your audio came in and her eyes opened up. It was almost like I was excited. I had tears in my eyes of anticipation. It was unbelievable.
It affected me actually kind of the same way, to be honest with you. It was an amazing piece of work. And it was, of course, Contact Backwards. And if you haven't seen it yet, you can go to artbell.com. And how's it listed as Ross's fourth or something like that?
I believe it is, if I can remember right. I'm a little bit sketchy, but I think you're in the ballpark.
Yeah, amazing. Just an amazing talent.
I'll tell you, I spent many years as a young police officer listening to you on the night shifts, and thank God you were there, because some of those nights were long indeed, and you made them bearable. So my hat's off to you.
Thank you.
And also, you know, I just you've got me into ham radio, and I appreciate you for that. And I just wanted to say hats off to you from everybody from Bell Gab, and welcome from Big Sky Country as well.
Thank you, my friend. Take care. All right. Well, there you have it. What am I going to do about this? Everybody wants to say welcome back. Now, Rush says dittos instead of doing all that. I don't know what I can come up with. I'll have to think about it. But let's accept the fact that you all welcome me back. That won't stop you, will it? So I'm not really sure what to do about that. Let's continue until I can think about it a little bit. Hello, Dark Matter, you're on the air. Hello?
Yeah, hi, this is Christopher. Can you hear me?
I hear you.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm on a Skype computer.
Uh-huh.
And I don't have much signal here. I'm at Safeway. I'm already Christopher Price. Christ is gender specific for Chris and short for Christopher. Solve a couple of problems on the computer, but it caused one great problem that created a rift.
Okay, Christopher, well, you're on the air, so if you have something to say, fire away.
Yeah, I have a device that can connect me to what I guess the Christians call eternity.
You don't have a gun, do you?
No, its physics is very simple. It has to do with the fire and vibration of tuning fork.
And that connects you to eternity?
Yes. Eternity is a place where Dr. Greer talked about it a little bit. That place is a vibrational, it's not really, it's a holographic place, but it's physical, but it transcends time and space.
Okay.
And so when you have...
Okay, this is not going to be a possible conversation because we just have too much delay. Cell phones are bad. Trying to do Skype with a bad connection to a radio show is almost beyond reason. He scared me there for a moment. There are, I guess, various avenues to eternity and scared me. Dark Matter, and you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art. This is Larry from Fort Lauderdale.
Hello, Larry.
You might remember. I had three quick things. One, please push XM into putting the channel numbers on the mobile phone devices. It's a good program.
I wonder why they don't do that.
Well, they want everybody to go to names, and I tried to tell them that the red network and blue network didn't work very well. You need numbers, because if you're in your car and you look at 104 and you try to figure out where it's listed, which is under entertainment, under indie, it's a problem. And I think they could find some room to do that, and I think that you're the man to do it. The second thing real quick was, if you can ever do the phase shifting version of Ride My Seesaw, that would be awesome. Like we used to hear.
I finally adopted it as a theme, so I'll dig it out one of these days. But
the third thing I wanted to say is that regarding Dr. Stephen Greer, the only thing that could probably keep people's lips so sealed and so secretive has to be that they truly believe that it would throw our Bible out the window, and the reason of our very existence would just be so different that it would be so cataclysmic if anybody opened their mouth, because you never could have this many people with that kind of a budget not leaking the Holy Grail or the absolute smoking gun, which would remove all doubt. And it would have to take something of that magnitude for them to keep this thing that secret. And that's
more oil. Oil is bigger than you think. I mean, oil is really, really big. We're talking big money. We're talking, we've had wars. Most of our wars, one way or the other, have had something to do with oil. So there is that. And then, as you point out, there's religion. And you're absolutely correct. If the reality of extraterrestrials meant that what we thought we knew about God and the Bible wasn't true, I think everything would rapidly get out of control.
think that we've been prepared enough to where we wouldn't. I think the Brookings Institute is not the same today as it would have been in the 50s. And I also think a soft landing is possible because it would in fact be gradual. If you took just here in South Florida, the Florida Power and Light Company, if all of a sudden we had a box in our yard and I didn't have to pay $300 and $400 a month, that money would be put back in.
Well, one thing that the market doesn't like is a surprise. You know, every time we've had some sort of surprise, whether it's a war, political leader dying, you know, whatever it is, any kind of surprise, the market takes a beating. If somebody talked about suddenly having free energy, that's a big surprise. I mean, that's so big that I'm not sure there'd be a recovery.
Well, the doctor laid it out. It's one way or the other. If we have a global warming and there's water covering my house where I'm at now, that's a pretty surprise. So I tend to go with his method, and I think that we could have the soft landing, and I think that we have to do that.
Okay. Well, thank you, and that's a good, intelligent call. I kept asking Dr. Greer about a soft landing, and I'm not sure that I got the answer or an answer that I understood or agreed with. A soft landing. If it was suddenly announced that energy was essentially free, I honestly don't know, folks. I really don't know. I don't think there would be a soft landing. I think there would be a hard crash, actually. All right, we'll break here. We'll continue in the hour with open lines and anything you want to talk about. It's all fair game. No screening of calls. Whatever comes, comes. And that last call was a good one. What do the rest of you think? Soft landing? Possible? I don't know. We're in open lines. Unscreened open lines. Dangerous territory, kind of. But interesting territory. So let's continue and see what we find. Good morning, I suspect. You're on Dark Matter.
Hello, old man. This is Tim from Ohio.
Old is right. How you doing?
Not bad. I want to congratulate you on the creation and successful launch of Dark Matter.
Thank you.
And I had a ham radio question for you. I was wondering if you're on D-Star at all yet.
You know, we played around with D-Star. D-Star is a digital form of communication that hams are playing with right now. And I've got to tell you, I was not all that impressed.
Okay, well, it's growing. You have the original reflectors that were created, but they're X reflectors now. I'm not sure if you're aware of that.
No, I'm not.
Yeah, X reflectors are like independent reflectors.
We've got to be careful here because a lot of the audience has no idea what we're talking about. It's a kind of a digital form of communication, and you know, it was I can't help but compare it to regular old FM, and you know,
right? Well, yeah, it is internet based, but the fun of it is like HF, and I'm pretty sure you hang on 80 meters. My call is NC8OS, Tim, but when you can sit and RF from your handheld into your DVAP and go out over the internet and talk around the world sitting on your couch on your handheld, as long as you have internet, it's pretty cool, I thought. And it is expensive. That's why a lot of people aren't into it yet, and I agree it's very high priced. But I think it's
okay,
one
well,
of the
so you've just said it. You've said it yourself. I mean, it is expensive. It is high priced. And on top of that, I don't like the way it sounds. I'm sorry. But you're right, I'm an old man. Now, old man is an affectionate term that ham radio operators use with each other, and that's how he meant it. But I guess I am old because, to me, traditional FM sounds wonderful. And these newer digital modes, not as much. They, you know, they hiccup. And, well, it's kind of like comparing a cell phone to a landline phone. And I know we've talked about this before, but I'm not wild about cell phones. And while I'm on the subject, you know, that can get me going on a rant. I want the cell phone companies, the big ones. Let's start with AT&T, for example. They're really a big one, right? Let's increase the bandwidth, folks. Let's hear pin drops again on cell phones. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Wouldn't it be absolutely astronomically wonderful to hear a pin drop on a cell phone again? The first company that does it is going to get my money. I will switch providers like that. Somebody comes up with a good sounding cell phone. Sorry, get me going on that. And anyway, Dark Matter, you're on the air. Hi.
Hey, Art. This is Nathan calling from Oregon.
Hey, Nathan.
Wanted to ask you, first of all, thanks for taking my call. First time caller, sure. Long time listener.
Sure.
Wanted to ask you where you're at with the Luciferian agenda, some things that Dr. Kaku alluded to last evening. Made us curious where you were at personally with that.
When did he reference that last night?
Well, he didn't reference it last night. He talked about some things that made us suspect that he may be in a position to know things that...
What was it he said that made you suspect that?
I'm having trouble remembering specifically.
All right. Instead of Dr. Kaku, let's just talk about the Luciferian agenda, whatever that is. What is the Luciferian agenda?
Well, the Luciferian agenda seems to be certain things in society breaking and moving according to a design that is not necessarily organic and one that is not necessarily benevolent. So some people might call it a shadow government. There's different boxes I think that it can fit into. But with everything that's happened and what it has it been, you know, 3 to 5 years that you've been off the air,
yes.
What we want to know is where you are personally with it and what you would speak to that might be indicative of that sort of agenda in place.
Okay. And, you know, it's an interesting question. Thank you very much. And I'll try and address it as best I can. The Luciferian agenda. Well, obviously, the implication is he's talking about Lucifer, right? Lucifer controlling matters here on Earth. I don't know. I don't necessarily buy it. I think that we're pretty much controlling matters. I said it earlier in the show tonight. These shootings that are continuing and continuing and seemingly getting more and more and more every day you wake up and you're afraid to turn on CNN or Fox or, you know, whatever your preference is. Al Jazeera, actually. Any one of them you turn on and suddenly there's 10 or 12 people dead or, God forbid, you know, student shot or whatever. It makes one think about a Luciferian agenda, but I think it's us. Something's going wrong. It's us. Now, I also think my comment toward the beginning of the show was fair, and that is that instead of controlling guns, we need to control people who are hearing voices. Seems to me that if you've got a secret clearance in the armed services, and you're going to, you know, psychiatrists, or going in for help because you hear voices, that there shouldn't have to be a lot more outpatient kind of treatment. At the point you hear voices, you should be cared for until you don't hear voices any longer. This just doesn't seem complicated to me. Now, I know that the people on CNN are going to rage about gun control now, just really going to have a heyday the way they did last time and every time. And it just gets more and more and more and more. But to me, it seems simple. You take care of the people who hear the voices and who seek psychological counseling and who display the kind of behavior that leads one to take a gun and to go in into a secure facility and begin killing people, and you take care of them. Dark Matter, you're on the air. Hello.
Hey, Art Bell.
So hey. I was thinking maybe when I hang up, maybe you could talk about the weather in the Philippines and what that's like. But I wanted to tell you a quick story.
I'm not in the Philippines right now, so I have no idea. But I can be confident in saying that it's warm and humid, sir.
Okay, all right, that's what I meant. I just meant in general. But I had a story where we were trying to destroy this guy's life in our neighborhood. We wanted to run him out of our neighborhood, and we got into it with the guy. Well, it was the guy was doing drugs in the house over there, and it really wasn't our business. Oh. It was a kind of a family, golf course type community there. But this guy had called us and told us the guy who bought the house in over there, he does drugs, and I'll help you run him out. I know how to run him out because I ran him out of our neighborhood and all this. And so anyway, we ended up getting into it with this guy, and he ends up running one of our friends out instead because he runs him out. So instead, we come up with a plan to go into the guy's house and put hidden cameras to film him using the drugs and doing stuff so we can then blackmail him, not really blackmail, but humiliate him and make him get out of the neighborhood.
Okay.
So we did it.
That seems like a dangerous path, but
Well, it was war. It was war because he ran our buddy out, and it was like we were desperate. We started up with this guy, and he wasn't leaving, and now he was keying up on us. We had to do something, and we kind of panicked by doing this. But we basically go into his house. We didn't have to break in. We actually had our locksmith buddy come over and make locks for the entire house, basically to get in and out of the house whenever we wanted to, because the video that we saw of the guy using the drugs and doing the drugs was so entertaining that we didn't want him to leave at that point. We started showing it to our neighbors on a pay-per-view basis and started selling it to everybody in the neighborhood. And then it spread from our subdivision to the next subdivision.
Hilarious.
And we set up an account for him, all right? We set up an account for him, minus our expenses, of course. And this went on for a long time until, basically he figured it out. People would recognize him in the community, but it was a big secret that, he would come home and do the drugs. And so it's a very long story.
Wait a minute. He knew he was being televised.
Well, at a point, he realized, because people knew him, he went to the store, and people would recognize him. We told people to shut up and don't look at him, and all this. But he eventually kind of figures out, and he stops doing the drugs. I mean, he goes cold turkey. He knows people are watching him. And so though we have this money's been piling up in here, surreptitiously. And so then we decide, because people started fading away and we weren't making the money, and so then we decide to buy the note on the guy's house, and then we basically, because he was a contractor, we just took over his life with the jobs that we would get, and then we stopped paying him. We stopped paying him for the job, and we'd only pay him a little bit, and we'd string it out, we'd get him to buy materials, then we'd screw him, and so then eventually he lost
the house. So before you know it, he's got a bullet with your name on it, right?
No, because we're doing this very carefully. His friends are in on this, but they're not helping him. The house goes into foreclosure. We make him homeless. Now people come back because now they have this guy that we created that's worth millions of dollars, but now we've made him homeless and he's living on the streets. So then that became the show. And everybody who got involved wanted to be part of it. Everybody from the Circle K store guys to people on the streets and it went on and on and made record amounts of money for anything. Only about 5% of the American people even know this is
Wait. Where was the money coming from? People were paying to see the next episode of Mr. Druggy?
Yes. Yeah. And, well, it was much more than that. I mean, it started out like that. It started out with this tweaked out guy bouncing around in his house with the lights off because he didn't want his neighbors to know he was up all night, and we had little laser lights in there. We'd be up in his attic. He'd be tweaked out.
I've got it. I just can't imagine people paying for an episode of somebody, sitting over in the corner with the lights out, as you just pointed out, stoned out of his mind. Great video. That's great stuff. Yes, sir. Well, maybe this is the age of reality TV, right? Dark Matter, you're on the air. Hello.
Hey, Art. Kyle from Portland, Oregon.
Hey there.
I was just wondering with the new show, if you have any plans on picking up your old tradition now that it's getting close to Halloween with the ghost shows.
Oh, somebody asked that last night. Yes, of course. We'll do ghosts on Halloween. Yeah. We'll do ghost stories from the audience on Halloween. You can depend
on it. Perfect. Perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
Oh, that's it, huh? All right. Thank you very much, and take care.
You too.
Let's see if we can go directly to this line and say you're on Dark Matter. Hi.
Hey, what's up, Art? Welcome back.
Thank you. You're up at the moment.
Good. My name's Greg. I'm calling from Philly.
Right.
And I just wanted to know if you plan on doing any shows with shadow people.
I would love to do a show with a shadow person, sir. All they've got to do is march in and actually say something.
Okay.
I'm joking with you. I mean, you're obviously asking, am I going to do a show about shadow people?
Yes. I saw one as a kid in a childhood house, and I think you may have done a program before on it. It was really interesting.
I think I started the program on shadow people. Do you think you can explain to people what shadow people are?
Well, I just know from my own experience as a kid, like when I would sleep in my childhood room in my hallway, I would see a shadowy figure look like a taller gentleman with like a trench coat and a hat on, and similar to the same figure that numerous other people have seen, which is kind of eerie.
Okay, now I haven't seen that. I know that other people have seen, and that's the classical, I believe, description of a shadow person, you know, the hat and the trench coat and all the rest.
I've not
seen that. What I have seen, though, are shadow figures. In other words, you know, in your peripheral vision, every now and then you will see movement. Everybody's had it. Almost everybody's had it.
Right.
And that's the best I've had. I've definitely seen movement that scared the hell out of me, to be honest with you. But at the corner of my vision, and it's never gone further than that. I've never had a talk with a shadow person. Now, if you can corral one for me, I'd love to interview them.
Yeah. Well,
all right.
Man. Welcome back. Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Sure. I bet the rest of you had that experience, right? You've seen that movement in the corner of your eye. Is it something? Is it something real? Is it just a trick of the eye? Well, I suppose sometimes it is. And sometimes it may be another life form that you're seeing with your peripheral vision, moving in and out of this existence, you know, that quickly. Hello there. This is Dark Matter, and you're on the air.
Hello?
Hello.
Hello, Art. How you doing?
Okay.
Well, you know what? I've been trying, like, for 15 years to get a hold of you, and I can't believe I'm talking to you now, which is cool. But anyway.
15 years of effort.
Yeah, and then now you come back, and guess what? I got like 6 XMs that I was going to cancel out that I listened coast to coast on. And, man, it's really cool to talk to you now. I can't believe it.
I'm glad you're here. What's up?
Nothing much, man. Yeah, I had a story to tell you about a Twilight Zone Outer Limits of the Third Kind that I experienced when I first found out about you back in 96, in the spring of 96, but... it's a long story, but if I ever get to talk to you again, I'll tell it to you. But it's just good to hear you, Art, and it's good to hear you that you're back again.
All right, my friend. Thank you very much for the call. After 15 years, the man calls, and he had a story all set and then decided not to tell it after 15 years of effort. You're on Dark Matter. Hello.
Hey, Art.
Hey.
Very long-time listener. I go back all the ways to the KDWN days.
Oh, that's a long way.
That's way back. Basically, mm-hmm. I grew up with you, my friend.
Okay, well,
I'm
welcome.
I know. I don't want to spend too much time on welcoming you back. Everybody else has done
Thank
that.
Thank you. Thank you.
God knows it's good to have you back.
Thank you.
I want to talk to you maybe a little bit about what's going on in your life now. Are you a full-time resident in Pahrump or back and forth still?
Well, good question. Full-time in Pahrump because my daughter is in school now, so that kind of you know, settles you in a little bit, but we'll still go to the Philippines every now and then.
Okay, so this could turn into a regular gig for you. Maybe we'll keep it. What is it now? Four nights a week?
It is, yes.
That'd be great. You know, if you could run that schedule for a while, you've got tons of committed listeners. We just need to get the word maybe out a little bit.
It'll leak out.
I don't want to disc the current Coast to Coast, but.
They lost
a lot of listeners.
You know what happened is that over time, it changed. It sort of, you know, I might suggest it lost focus a little bit and changed.
Of course it changed. And the big change was you and the style. It wasn't your style anymore. I don't care what wacky guests you had on all those years. You were never afraid to confront them. You were never afraid to ask them the real questions. And you never sugarcoated it or, you know, fed them softballs.
I try not to do any of that. Yeah, I don't like sugarcoating. I like to get right to the heart of the matter, whatever the matter is, and just do it.
You know, and I mean, and if it's, you gave everybody their chance and everybody could say their speech, but if it was something that was completely a complete wack,
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to call anybody on anything that is completely whack.
No, and you never were. Unfortunately, the show took a different direction, and they lost a bunch of committed listeners.
It did. You know, but yes, it did. But on the other hand, the host who takes over has the right to take the show in any direction he or she wishes. It's their show. Now, yes, the show took a different direction. You know what? I don't really want to comment much more on that, but I think you all are sort of with me and understand, right? Dark Matter, you're on the air.
Dittos, Art. Dean from Kalamazoo, Michigan.
I wonder if we could steal that from Rush.
Why not?
Maybe there's no other answer. Dittos would work.
I was trying to save time.
I hate to ask, but what kind of phone are you on?
I'm sorry, Samsung smartphone. Not so smart.
It's terrible. Terrible.
I know. It's all I had available.
Sounds like you're on a speakerphone that's on the other side of the bathroom.
Empty conference room, buddy.
An empty conference room. Okay, that'll do.
All right. I have two very quick UFO stories. I tried to tell you 15 years ago, but now I got my chance. I've always been interested in UFOs. My dad was a logger up north in the UP of Michigan, and he always kind of dissed me and thought that was kind of a bunch of waste of time. And I was surprised one morning about 5 a.m. he woke me up. This guy, you got to understand, never smoked, never drank. UFOs were bunk. Everything was bunk to him. And he was sitting out on his truck in the woods at nearly 5, and he heard a noise behind him. He was one of those big logging trucks. They got the big crane, the hand that picks up the logs and puts them in the back of the truck.
Oh yeah.
So he turns around and he looks, and he knows the area well. It's dark, but he knows the area well. And there's an open area. There's a little lake there, and that's where the noise is coming from. He turns and looks, and out from the gap, you can't tell it came from the water, but water was dripping from it, was a 15-foot object, which was just with lights going around, just kind of like a helicopter lights where they're kind of going on and off, but it's a round circular object. Thing just came out of the water dripping, hovered there for a second, just off it went. And he, of course, knowing I was interested, rushed back, get me to, you know, tell the story to me and brought me out there. No trace of anything, but for me, although I'd always wanted to see a UFO, I thought, well, this is proof, because if my dad saw one, they got to be real, because this guy just didn't have to be honest.
Okay, but it was your dad, not you, right?
It was my dad.
Okay. Well, all right. Here's the deal, folks. I appreciate the story, but it was secondhand. you know, I know close at hand with your dad. But if you ever see one yourself, it's going to change your life. You know, I understand people joke about this and make light of it. And, you know, I've heard the other radio hosts just, you know, really goofing on it. But the fact of the matter is, if you have a real experience, and I had one, your own eyes, close enough that you feel like you could touch it, it will change your life. You will go into sort of a period of shock. You will even go into denial about what you saw, but there is no question about what you saw. In my case, it was a triangle. It was immediately above my head. It was floating, not flying. It couldn't have been doing more than 45 miles an hour. It was deadly silent, so silent you could hear crickets a quarter of a mile away. It was the real McCoy. And once you have seen this, you can't go back. So I appreciate the story, but I appreciate first-person stories more. They're very impactful. Hearing stories about my brother who saw one or my dad who saw one, while interesting, not quite the same. Dark Matter, and you're on the air.
Hey, Art, this is Blair in Sedona.
Hey there.
I was listening to a show you did with Dr. Stephen Greer back in 2004 when you had the ABC film cameras in. Remember that Peter Jennings. Yeah.
Yes, of course I remember.
Yeah, and then you played a metallic-sounding man's voice. This is Don't Mess Into Government Matters, too.
No, I didn't. Just so you know, I didn't play any voice.
Well, no, you played a recording that Dr. Greer had sent you that was on his phone.
Okay, gotcha.
He's
been threatened. People who deal in this kind of thing get threatened. It's the truth. A lot of people scoff at it, don't believe it, but it's true.
Well, now, how long ago was it that we had this rash of microbiologists being killed? I got up to about 500 of them. Remember that part?
I'm not sure if it was 500, but it was a lot.
It was a lot. So here, okay, so they're telling, so that I'm using the word they, okay, microbiologists, you know, you take notice. Now, your life is at risk unless you don't play ball, and now they're doing this with the disclosure folks. So mm-hmm. It sounds to me like they want to have a population reduction, mass one, before this will be released. What do you think, Art?
I think they want to have an information reduction.
Oh, the other direction. So we're going into de-evolution then, huh?
Well, in a way. Now, let me ask you, if you had information of the type that Dr. Greer has, and somebody came into your home and calmly but forcefully said to you, here it is, sir, this is a bullet and it's got your name on it. Open your mouth again, and not just your life, but that of your family and people you care about will be snuffed out. Either that or you shut your mouth. What would you do?
You know, my heart says, oh, go through with it, because here I'm a single guy, no wife, no kids, but, you know, and I have my dad died. Well, I'm 62. I'm collecting Social Security. I just started collecting Social Security just this month.
Congratulations, but you're not answering the question. The bullet has your name on it and your family's name on it. What are you going to do?
Yeah, I guess you'd have to say I have to think of my family over my stuff first and allow that to shut myself up and then maybe write it down somewhere.
All right, sir. I've got to go. You answered the question. Thank you. Let's punch this one. Hi there, Dark Matter, and you're on the air.
Hi, Art. This is Tom in Lee County, New Mexico.
Hey, Tom.
And just this past weekend, we had our 40th high school class reunion. And also 4 years ago this past summer is when I had my first experience with a UFO. We're 100 miles from Roswell.
Yes, sir.
And there's four of us out driving around in my 72 Monte Carlo, straight out of high school. We go out to a cemetery to look at this saying on this tombstone, where I am now, you shall be, was the end of the saying. But anyway, we're driving back to the highway. And we see some stars out in the distance, or the guys in the car did. And I said, hey, those stars are moving. And I said, nah, they're not. And I kept driving down the road. I got to looking, and they were. They were sitting up there doing the zigzag thing. So we drove on across the highway, pulled over, and sure enough, one of them stayed out there and started zigzagging. One of them came right up on us, went across the road, went back over, scared the other guys. They all ran back and got in the car. I stood out there. He tilted over. I could see in the cockpit. And now that I've watched a lot of Discovery Channel. And
what did this, what was the shape of this thing? You said cockpit. Was the shape?
It was a disc. A disc with a glass cockpit on top.
On top, okay.
And, yeah. And now I've told people about this before. You know, like I said, it happened 4 years ago. I'm 58 now. And every year this time of year, I go, yeah, they'll be back. They'll be back. And I keep looking for them, but it hadn't happened. Anyway, I was in my mechanics, getting a fuel pump, put in my pickup not long ago, and was telling him about it. And he said, you know, that rancher out there on the Arkansas Junction said he used to have mutilated cattle out there.
Mm-hmm.
And that just kind of confirmed my thing. But what I was going to get back to, you know, after all these years of watching the Discovery Channel and all that stuff on TV,
right,
looking in that cockpit, it looked, I think now, that the guy in there was a human being from White Sands or Holloman over there at Alamogordo, and it was a U.S. Air Force pilot in a high-altitude suit.
Okay, so you're saying you definitely saw...
On it now.
You definitely saw a human being in this craft.
No, I saw something in what I think now was a high-altitude suit that the U-2 pilots wore and the pilots in the SR-71s wore back
right,
then.
But the implication is it was a human being in the suit.
Yes, that's what I think now. You know, back then, I did not know. I thought it was an alien craft, but as I've grown older and seen more things, and, you know, human eyewitnesses accounts aren't good, but I had one, but my mind has taken me to that point now that I think it was a human being in that craft.
Well, it doesn't much matter one way or the other whether it was a human being in that craft, which is obviously secret, very, very secret, over on the other side. You know, we were talking about two governments earlier. This one would be way
right
over in the black area. So that's really interesting if we've developed that kind of anti-gravity technology. Think about it.
In 1973.
Then we would have everything that Dr. Greer talked about tonight. We'd have we'd have energy for the world. That means that they've really got it. They're really holding it. And so everything Dr. Greer said was true.
Yeah, I've been researching Dr. Greer here lately, and, you know, we're kind of the same age, and I've listened to some of his stuff, and he talks about extraterrestrial craft and human craft.
So either way you look at it, either way, it's a gigantic story, right?
You're right, yeah. And I'm also an oil guy, and you talk about a soft landing. we cannot have a soft landing if you crash the oil market. Our economy depends on it.
I do agree with that, and thank you. We're way out of time. Thank you very much for the call. I agree with you. We're not going to have a soft landing if this really happens.
Yeah, and I grew up.
The markets are going to crash.
Over there,
you know, dogs and cats are going to get along, and I just don't think it's going to work. But I'm here, and as she said, I'm listening. See you tomorrow night. Good night, all.